Please. Terrific. Thank you very much. Welcome to the October 15th Select Board meeting. This meeting is called to order at 6:30 p.m. We have a couple of Select Board members who are going to be a few minutes late, but we're going to get started because we have a very full agenda. First of all, are there folks here for public comment? All right, first, Mr. Butler. Yep, come forward. All right, both of you together, single, whatever you want. You can comment about anything you want during public comment. Just please identify yourself for folks at home.
Paige Wilder, Precinct 10. I had a few comments about the safe and healthy neighborhoods materials that are given out, I presume, to students. I was looking through the packet that the Select Board received for tonight's meeting. There's one, it looks like a trifold brochure, and there are typos throughout it and grammatical errors, and I couldn't take it very seriously because of that. I'm hoping it's just a draft. The other thing is, I think that one of the big concerns that is not addressed in that pamphlet is midterm evictions for students. As there's enforcement of the nuisance bylaws, I'm hoping that students are being made aware of the possibility that they could be evicted. And there's the eviction process, but in addition to that, there's the private nuisance state law by which a landlord can trespass a student out of a house for criminal behavior in a very short period of time. So I'm hoping the off-campus student housing department or the brochures or something gives students a heads up about that. It also, there's a statement in one of the brochures that says, tell your neighbors that you're having a party, that they may call you before they call the police. I don't think that should even be suggested. I don't think it's the neighbor's duty to police their neighbors. I think that that just gives the students the idea that they can do whatever they want until the neighbors call. The other thing is that I think somehow we need to reframe the idea of a party, because 100 to 300 people that you don't know at your house is not a party. And so the brochure legitimizes a party, and if you let your neighbors know there's a party, that's one thing. But if you're having 100 to 200, 300 people come that you don't know, that's a whole nother issue, and that's not even appropriate.
Okay, thank you very much. Other folks for public comment? Mr. Carlstrom. And please identify yourself.
Hi, I'm Rolf Carlstrom, Precinct 10. Thank you, Ms. O'Keefe. I submitted late last week a document, and I just very briefly like to say that I appreciate your considering it. As neighbors, I think one of the most important things from our point of view that the town manager has done in his term is institute the Safe and Healthy Neighborhoods program. I think it's a wonderful program. We're fully in support, and I think it's important that his evaluation reflect his efforts in this area. So we've drafted a few criteria for the town manager evaluation that are centered on the neighborhood issues and the safe and healthy neighborhood program. So if there is going to be discussion of this, I don't think now isn't obviously in the time, but I was wondering if there is discussion on this, when that's likely to happen.
It's hard to know. That's an untimed item, so we'll fit it in when we can during the meeting.
Okay. I guess I would, because I'm going out of town tomorrow, so if that discussion is going to take place and if there isn't any urgency in getting it done, I would ask that could be postponed on November 5th Select Board meeting, then I could be there for that discussion.
Okay. I can't know how that discussion will go.
That's just a request. Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Anyone else? Public comment? Okay, then we will do a couple of untimed items, some easy ones that we can do without all the Select Board members here. Ms. Stein, would you like to make the motions on, we'll start with taxi licenses?
Sure. To find them. Okay. I move that the Select Board move approval of a new taxi/chauffeur license for Edward P. Bogard of Amherst on behalf of Green Cab Company.
Second.
Further discussion. All in favor say aye.
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 I move that the Select Board approve a new taxi chauffeur license for Corey Reinhardt of Springfield on behalf of Gotta Go Taxi.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 It's unanimous, two absent. About common victualler's licenses.
Okay, let's get this pile down here. Do you want to start with the all alcohol licenses? It's at the top.
Either one, sure.
I move that the select board approve all alcohol licenses for each reception scheduled on the following dates and premises of the UMass Amherst Campus Center. No, yeah, it should be center. Listed below, Meredith Schmidt, Campus Center Director. So you noticed, John, that I put in the word center. Okay, October 20th, 2012, from 6 p.m. to 12 a.m. at the Fine Arts Center. October 24th, 2012, from 5 p.m. to 9 p.m. at Goodell Library, Bernie Dallas Room. December 10th, 2012, from 4 p.m. to 6:30 p.m. at the Fine Arts Center.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Just more on my list, that's all.
I move that the select board approve special wine and malt licenses for each reception scheduled on the following dates and premises of the UMass Amherst Campus Center, listed below, Meredith Schmidt, Campus Center Director. October 27th, 2012, from 12 p.m. to 4 p.m. at Furkelo Hall, School of Education Lawn, UMass. October 27th, 2012, from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. at the Eisenberg School of Management Atrium, UMass. October 27th, 2012, from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. at the Student Union Lawn, UMass. November 10th, 2012, from 7 p.m. to 11 p.m. at the Fine Arts Center, UMass.
Second.
Further discussion? And so I'll just note that actually the word center, it shouldn't say campus center in the original part because it's talking about locations all over campus.
Oh, okay.
Right.
And that would be the same for both of them. So
you're right.
We can just strike that. All right, further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. That's 3-0. One arriving. All right, let's see. What else do we have here? Oh, common vic.
The common vic. I move that the select board approve a common victualler license for Survival Centers Incorporated doing business as Amherst Survival Center, 138 Sunderland Road, Monday, Tuesday, and Friday, 11 a.m. to 3 p.m., Thursday, 11 a.m. to 7 p.m., Cheryl Zoll, Executive Director, pending issuance until any/all outstanding town department regulations have been satisfied.
Enthusiastically second.
Further discussion? So this is just noting, this is for their new location. So they had one at their old location. This is getting them ready for the new one.
Right.
All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. That is unanimous.
I move that the select board approve a common victualler license for Advanced Fresh Concepts franchise doing business as AFC Sushi at Big Y, number 46, 175 University Drive, Monday through Sunday from 9 a.m. to 7 p.m., Aaron Liang, manager, pending issuance until any/all outstanding town department regulations have been satisfied.
Second.
Further discussion? I'll just note that we typically have new businesses come in to do a little commercial for their new business for a common vic. This is not a new business. This is a new offering at Big Y that happens to need a common victualler's license, so we didn't make them come in for that. But just so people know, there will now be new sushi at Big Y.
Hey.
All right, further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. That is unanimous. Okay. About committee appointments.
I move that the select board confirm the town manager's appointments of Laura Lovett to the Historical Commission with a term to expire June 30th, 2013, Judith Moran to the Historical Commission with a term to expire June 30th, 2015, and Jim Brissett to the Leisure Services and Supplemental Education Commission with a term to expire June 30th, 2014.
Second.
Further discussion. And we noted in discussion before the meeting, the reason that different committee appointments have different terms is they get staggered so that the seats remain three-year turnover seats for the ones where that matters. Okay, further discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. That's unanimous.
I move that the Select Board approve the appointment of William Stenzel of Amherst to the Kanakasaki Sister City Committee for a term to expire June 30th, 2015. No need to stagger for that committee.
Second.
Further discussion. So those appointment letters are already made out. Nobody minds if I just cross out that date then rather than having to go through reissuing them again. All right, further discussion. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. That's unanimous. Okay, how are we doing here? 6:41, a couple more minutes. What else can we get through here? Mr. Wild, would you like to do the resolution honoring the African American Revolutionary War soldiers?
We could do that. How would you like to proceed?
Yep. 4 minutes. You can either explain it and then read it, or you could just read it and see what still needs to be explained, or tell us how it came about. Anything you prefer?
Find the copy in my packet. let me try to explain it first. What this is about, it's an ongoing effort to honor African Americans who fought in the Revolutionary War. As you know, in the beginning of commemorative processes in this country, there was discrimination. For example, the Daughters of the American Revolution didn't want to recognize African Americans who'd fought in the war for various reasons and so forth. That's been largely resolved, but there is no monument to the African Americans who fought in the Revolutionary War, perhaps 5,000. Several thousand Native Americans also fought on the Patriot side. And there was, some years ago, a proposal to create a monument on the National Mall in Washington. For various reasons, that didn't come to pass. But a group of concerned citizens, descendants of some of these soldiers, has attempted to revive that proposal, now to find a parcel somewhere off the mall. So the idea here is to get towns that whose residents were part of this effort to pass resolutions in favor of such a monument and to express their support for that proposal to their state and national representatives. So it's part of a national effort. It's taking hold, doing quite well in Massachusetts and Connecticut. And we were asked, this was the Massachusetts Municipal Association publicized this effort last year, and now we're taking action on it and hope that it'll be received favorably. It's a very long and complicated resolution. I don't know if we want to read it in its entirety. There were apparently two residents of, I should correct myself, two men who fought on behalf of Amherst in the Revolution. Some lists suggest three. I think the names are duplicated. So there was one who was an Amherst resident, definitely proven, and another one, as was often the case, was a resident from somewhere else who apparently fought in an Amherst unit. So we have two particular soldiers here that we would be honoring as part of this larger national effort.
Would you prefer to read it, or would you prefer to just refer to it in the motion?
Since it's so long, I think if you have a copy handy, I'm looking for my copy. Thank you.
Could read the resolve.
Yeah. I think I'll just read a couple of paragraphs of it, okay?
Certainly.
Whereas Senator Joseph Lieberman of Connecticut and Senator Charles Grassley of Iowa have introduced S-883, the National Liberty Memorial Act, in the U.S. Senate to complete the unfinished business of 2 decades, the construction of an entirely citizen-funded National Liberty Memorial to African Americans of the Revolutionary War at a location in the monumental core of Washington, D.C., and whereas from 1775 to 1783, an estimated 5,000 to 10,000 slaves and free persons served as soldiers, Marines, and patriots in the Revolutionary War, in addition to tens of thousands of men, women, and children who provided civilian assistance, ran away from slavery, and petitioned courts and legislators for freedom, and whereas more than 1,570 African Americans served in the Revolutionary War from 194 of 351 municipalities in all 14 counties of Massachusetts, and whereas 2 African American soldiers and patriots from Amherst, Caesar Prutt and William Ewing, participated in the struggle for independence, and I'll skip ahead to the end here, be it resolved that the Select Board of the Town of Amherst joins the National Mall Liberty Fund DC, the congressional sponsors and original co-sponsors of the National Liberty Memorial Act, including Representative Donald Payne of New Jersey and Representative Frank Wolf of Virginia, and those who applaud the decision of Congress and President Reagan in 1988 to authorize the predecessor memorial at a site between the Washington Monument and Lincoln Memorial. And the final passages then say that we encourage volunteers to explore the history of African-American revolutionary participation. We urge the Massachusetts delegations to the U.S. Senate and Congress to support this act, and we will pass these recommendations along to our elected officials.
Second.
Thank you. All right, so we'll consider that to be Mr. Wald having made the motion, Mr. Hayden having seconded it. Is there further discussion? I'd like to appreciate Mr. Wald's initiative in taking this on, paying attention to this and getting the resolution all ready for us to deal with. So thank you very much, very well done. Ms. Brewer.
I would just mention, associated with the motion itself,
could you speak into your mic, please?
That it's not a proposed resolution anymore, but however we want to phrase it on the actual motion sheet.
Oh, correct. Mm-hmm.
So the resolution has been read, so.
Right.
We're kind of skipping the motion part.
Okay.
All right, so it's been read, hence moved and seconded for the discussion. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Aye. And that was unanimous. Thank you very much. All right, good timing, 6:46. Our next item is a report from Mr. Musanti and the staff team of the Safe and Healthy Neighborhoods Initiative. We've been getting updates on the Safe and Healthy Neighborhoods activities for many meetings, and we have recently instituted a plan to do this the second meeting of every month. In talking about it, we decided that a more thorough status report of kind of exactly where each piece of it is right now and what recommended next steps would be appropriate for this meeting, and so that's what we're gonna do. Mr. Musanti. Oh, and I'm sorry, one more thing. There is a great deal of information about this agenda topic available in the Select Board's packet, all of which is on the website. So folks who are paying attention at home, and let me just give you a little pro tip for if you're using the web packets at home. If you click on the part that says the name of the items when you go to the packet file, it rearranges everything so it goes in the order that we discuss them typically at meetings, except for the untimed items fall at the very bottom. So if you're trying to follow along, especially when we have like 40 documents or something, that's a good way to make sure they're in the right order. So so folks can follow along with all the same information we have. Mr. Musanti.
Thank you. That was my introduction. So I'm pleased to provide an update. I'm joined tonight by several of our key staff who are working with neighborhood residents, landlords, property owners, and each other, and the university in particular, to take action steps to stabilize and improve the quality of life in all of our Amherst neighborhoods, but in particular neighborhoods that have been affected with a growing number of rental properties. The past few months have been marked by I think a lot of developments, positive action. What's clear though from the day-to-day, week-to-week experience is that some of the issues we're confronting are very real and do not have easy solutions. But particularly over the summer and now into the fall, we've been able to ramp up our efforts, and I want to highlight a few of those for you and then devote several minutes each to reports from our Building Commissioner Rob Mora, Health Director Julie Fetterman, Fire Chief Tim Nelson, Police Chief Scott Livingstone, about progress reports in their particular areas as it relates to the Safe and Healthy Neighborhoods Initiative. And then I want to conclude our presentation with a description of some key next steps. I think highlights of the progress report, very briefly before you hear a lot of the details. There's been a lot of outreach, and that's ongoing. With students, neighbors, rental property managers, landlords, university officials, to talk about concerns and talk about possible strategies to create some positive change. We have ramped up our inspection and code enforcement efforts. We hired a full-time code enforcement officer, John Thompson, who's also here with us tonight. He began with us part-time in the early part of this year and transitioned to full-time in June. And you'll hear from Inspection Services how that has translated into a more responsive and active effort on the part of code enforcement. Health Department, we're noting meaningful progress in decreasing, but not eliminating, the amount of overflowing household trash, upholstered furniture, discarded mattresses, things like that, in some problem properties and areas that have been known to be problems in the past. Julie can update you on that and other initiatives in the Health Department. Just this past Friday night, we began in collaboration, coordination with the UMass Police Department, joint patrols, in starting with neighborhoods nearest to the southwest residential area of the UMass campus, primarily Sunset, Phillips, Fearing, Lincoln Avenue. And that's what we hope is a partnership that we will build on with some meaningful results in deterring inappropriate behavior and increasing our own visibility. And lastly, the university at our urging and with their own initiative has updated and created a report on student conduct and discipline cases through the Dean of Students Office and Vice Chancellor, Associate Vice Chancellor Enku Galai. And there is a community forum occurring tomorrow night, the 16th of October at 6 p.m. in the community room at the UMass Police Station on East Pleasant Street, and encouraging members of the community to attend, hear from the Dean of Students, but also have an opportunity to meet the new UMass Police Chief. So with that, I want to turn it over to staff, and we'll hear for about 3 minutes each or thereabouts, plus or minus, first Rob Mora, Building Commissioner, then Health, Fire, and Police.
Good evening. I'm going to be referring to a memo I sent to Mr. Musanti in your package, along with a Excel spreadsheet here. Basically, we're talking about two things tonight as progress we are making in Inspection Services: complaint tracking and follow-up, and some new inspection programs that we've initiated here in Amherst. Complaints are historically been filed with the office, and very little tracking and follow-up or any evidence of that I've been able to find. So we're really instituting the first program to follow through on complaints here now, and we are working with IT to come up with better online complaint filing and monitoring from the public. But basically what I want to talk about is work that's taken place and some progress we've made since June 1st. That's when we really started tracking complaints here from the day they come in through to resolution or status of where we are at any particular point of the investigation or compliance process. So we've recorded 64 complaints, combination of zoning or any type of code violation that has been brought to our office, and you know, as a result, we've successfully seen 33 of those through to some sort of a resolution, compliance with either the building code, health codes, or zoning bylaws. There are a number of these zoning related cases that take quite a while to resolve, and a extensive amount of research and investigation and follow-up before we can get a plan together and make efforts to work with the property owners and landlords and managers. So we are doing that. We are working on that daily. And those are the ones that fall in the under investigation category. They're actively worked on, and we set timelines, and we check in on those as necessary. What we have seen out there really required me to think about what are we going to do with some of these properties that we don't get to see periodically. And it's not just a complaint response, but we need to start looking at some of these structures for life safety. Fire escapes, as an example, the building code requires that they be inspected every 5 years. Again, no evidence of that being done. So we're out there, John Thompson and I are working, checking out the neighborhoods. We've started with one or two areas that we feel we could handle the volume of properties that we're looking at one time, and reaching out to those property owners and making them aware of regulations and their responsibilities and obligations as a property owner. So that's going to be what really builds our periodic inspection program that we are obligated to do under code or respond to under code now, and also really make a difference in these neighborhoods. From the public view, things that, holes in siding, holes in roofs, like I said, fire escapes. At the same time, we're able to get some information on some zoning regulations we have regarding parking of vehicles. Most of our zoning complaints that are resolved quickly are parking related. We've issued a couple of citations. It's very new. We recently received the ticket information from the police department, and just started that a couple of weeks ago. So we expect to see that become much more active. In fact, today we were discussing a third citation that'll be going out in the morning. So I think that's where we are today.
Very good.
Okay, we'll do all the summaries, and then select board can ask questions, and we'll get public comment.
Yeah. Now we'll have Julie Fetterman, our health director.
Good evening. I think I'll refer you to your packet. I know you probably received a number of items. Back in January 2010, the health department refocused its priority on our core functions, one of which is responding to housing complaints. Since that time, we've changed a lot of the ways in which we approach the issue of housing complaints, because one of the only ways, the only way that we get into a property is when someone calls and makes a complaint about it, or is an occupant and invites us in because they have a concern. So what we have done is decrease our response time so that we're getting out to all the properties within 24 hours. Once we're there, we offer tenants a full comprehensive inspection. If someone calls about, and landlords, if someone calls about one issue, we're called out on that specific issue, but it's now become our policy that everyone is offered a comprehensive inspection that's explained to people. And while we're there, we do our best to educate the occupant and the landlord property manager about what it is exactly we're seeing, what the order to correct that we're going to write up is going to include. So the education and the process of trying to bring that property into compliance starts the minute we come through the door. Another thing that we began, it seems funny to think, but back in the day, we didn't have email contact for all of our properties. So we're collecting all of that information. We've seen that really increase the communication between inspectors and those folks who are working on the properties. So there's a lot of communication flow going back and forth. I think that's really contributed to more timely repairs happening in properties. You'll also notice that we started partnering with UMass to do some education of landlords and tenants. We also started working closely with the UMass off-campus housing services so that we now have a relationship with them. If there are things that we want to post on the website, we'll be able to do that. They're also coming to us with some ideas and things they're seeing in the community, because there's staff at UMass Off Campus Services that works really closely with a lot of the landlords in the area. Another thing that we've done is start at the beginning of the semester and at the end of the school year, educating tenants and property owners in some of the neighborhoods where there have historically been issues about what our expectations are and what the responsibilities are for occupants and for landlords. And we feel that we've seen a real decrease in how much appears on the streets in the neighborhoods. And so we're continuing to do that annually. We're also looking at what other types of initiatives we could come up with. We're at this point looking at move in and move out and how we could make those particular periods of time be a little cleaner. You've all got our Living Off Campus in Amherst pamphlet. We're kind of excited about this. Again, we've gone around to specific neighborhoods where there are historically issues, and the feedback we've gotten from landlords and property owners is that they're really happy that we're doing this. And some of them are approaching us now so that they can get this and give it to their tenants when they sign a lease. So there's a lot of communication going back and forth. You have an Excel spreadsheet from us too. We track all of the complaints that come into our department. This is mandated by the state, so we've always done this. What's new is now we're going to be documenting what's a rental and what isn't a rental to see what how much of a percentage of our rentals really comprise our complaints. You'll see under action, OTC, order to correct. That's what the state mandates. Once a health inspector goes out to a property, we use the state sanitary code, and there are certain timetables for every type of infraction that we find. So an order to correct may be written, and all the things that were found on the property have to be corrected within 30 days. Other more crucial things, it may be within 5 days. Some things are within 24 hours. For instance, no heat, no hot water. I just wanted to explain to you a little bit what that was. So I don't want to take up too much of your time because you've got this big packet and there are several of us. Those are the highlights.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'd ask Chief Tim Nelson update us on fire department.
Evening. Well, as we, as, you know, well, following the theme here, one of the big changes for us and it's had a great effect, I think, is that I did an addition of a full-time fire inspector to help focus on those, on all these problems that we've been talking about, and that's in the last year. And it's allowed us to kind of make a team approach with our partners here. We all go out and see different things at different times, which may be within the purview of a different department. So the team approach is a way to go, and we've been, you know, focusing on, you know, those quality of life items, and focusing on just general safety. And one of the things one of the big things that we do is we want to work with the landlords and our tenants, because the first thought is that we're there to be punitive, and that's not really, I mean, there are times where that isn't necessary, but the goal is to gain compliance. And again, we don't want the folks to think that we're there with the big bat. If we have to, well, okay. But we want folks to comply and let them know that we're here. We're there to help. And it's tough, especially as we focus on rental properties. Most of those are single family homes, and the law prohibits us without an invitation to go in and inspect. So our entry is through complaints, but we still have to be invited in. or as a result of, say, a fire in incident, a fire alarm, or something like that, and we arrive and we see that there's an issue, then we can go on from there, or notify our partners. And it's at times it's hard to quantify what we do, because you don't, because there's the fire that does not happen. Folks that don't get hurt, because we've been there and gotten them to comply with the law and the code. But that doesn't belie the fact that it is quite effective, and there's just a lot of work left to do. So thank you.
Ask Police Chief Scott Livingstone to go next.
Good evening. So I believe the package you have before you from the police department is a comparison data from 2011 to 2012 for specific dates. Those dates being the beginning of July to the current time. And most of them are, you know, what we have gotten used to and referring to as quality of life issues. So in a nutshell, you can see that the summons enforcement and also the arrest, the enforcement for summonses is up. The arrests are a little bit down slightly. Nuisance house violations are up a little bit. Total, substantially with summonses, and down a little bit with the arrest, and usually the reason being for that is the officers are a little reluctant to make arrests on extremely busy evenings because of the time involved to make those arrests. So a lot of it depends on the actual behavior of the students. If it really warrants an arrest, then regardless of how busy we are, they'll go ahead and make those arrests. But summons is the better way to go for us. In regards to that, specific to noise complaints and police actions, we've been able to tell it, you know, still only about 15% of noise responses by the police receive punitive action, and that's a good thing. That means that most of the noise disturbances that we respond to, and they're pretty much hold steady anywhere from 1,000 to 1,200 per year. most of those are met with cooperation from the students. So only about 15% of those responses involve either arrest, summonses, or TBL violations. That's good news, but last year it was about 10%. So it's still low, but it's kind of trending upwards in regards to that. So, you know, we need to continue to do our educational initiatives when we can and make sure that the word gets out there with all of our partners that, you know, certain behavior is not acceptable, and be very specific about what type of behavior that is that'll get kids into trouble. So areas we need to continue to work on. out of all the noise disturbances that we've responded to so far this year, only 13 have been repeat offenses. So that's also good news. On the other hand, you know, we're still continuing to get pretty consistent stats on the number of actual noise disturbances that we respond to. So a lot of that has to do with the changes in the students that are living off campus and continuing to get the word out there about behavior, which is appropriate, which isn't. That's about it as far as that specific sheet involving the quality of life issues, you know, areas that we're continuing to work on. The officers themselves always do follow-up, usually on Monday or Tuesday mornings. They respond to properties that we had issues with, and they kind of greet the students in the mornings or afternoons and just kind of go over with them. They're usually different officers than actually were involved in either the arrest or the summons. These would be day shift officers and say, hey, listen, you know, there was a response here this weekend. You know, you guys either got arrested or summons. Obviously, you're aware of that. Here's what you need to do to make it better. So that's an opportunity for the officers just to talk with the students and stuff and let them know that, like, look, you messed up, but there's ways of fixing it. So that's a continued process that the officers do whenever we have the time to do that. So there's always continued follow-up by the officers whenever we can do that. You know, we continue to work with the landlords and our initiatives with the Campus and Community Coalition. We meet regularly, frequently with a lot of the landlords that live in town. You know, Steve Walczak at Puffton, the Joneses, Kurt Shumway, Albino. Those are continuing dialogues. And most of those people I mentioned are very good landlords, and we don't have a lot of issues with their properties. You know, the Campus and Community Coalition, I think everybody's very aware of the work that we're doing. And that's continued work in progress. We've had some successes last spring specifically, and then we took a couple of steps back this fall. So, you know, we knew we were in it for the long haul, and, you know, we're not, you know, we're going to keep working on that. So my staff, we meet weekly, all of my staff, sergeants, lieutenants, captains, just to go over the week's activity. Keep everybody abreast on specific properties or issues that we have to deal with. And last but not least, the town manager mentioned, I rode around with Chief Horvath this past Friday night for about 3 hours. We rode around together. I showed him the neighborhoods and the properties that are concerning to us, and, you know, discussed methods that they could be of assistance to us aside from our mutual patrols, areas that we would like to see them try and concentrate some of their efforts on. We had an excellent discussion, and we're going to continue those discussions. So I think that's about it. All right.
Thank you.
Great, thank you. And let me talk for a moment about key next steps. It's clear that the on-the-ground action, the collaboration, coordination between the many town departments involved in this effort and with members of the community is enhanced and better than it's been in a while. But it's clear that so far, at least, the results have been mixed, and that there is much work that remains to be done. To that end, and I've outlined this in some detail in my memorandum to the Select Board in tonight's packet, I've invited several members of the community from a variety of so-called stakeholder groups to work together with me and town staff on what I am calling a Safe and Healthy Neighborhoods Working Group. And it's really to finish the work that's been begun in earnest over the last year or so to develop a specific action-oriented proposals, and specifically in the run-up to annual town meeting this spring, this coming spring, and bring back recommendations to me in a couple of key areas that can then be brought forward for consideration by the Select Board and by Amherst Town Meeting next spring. Specifically, I want the working group to research, finish the research, and finish the reviewing of programs of residential rental regulations, looking at primarily college towns. And I have several such examples that I've gained even in the last week talking to my colleagues from across the country who are college town managers, and bring back recommendations by March 1st to me. It's really focused on 8 or 9 key areas. Rental registration itself, special permit requirements, a bona fide pre-inspection program of rental units, coupled with a regular inspection program, clear penalties for violations, more specific and clear requirements on parking requirements, improved upon language related to exterior maintenance requirements for rental properties in particular. The creation, if one doesn't exist already, of a property management plan. Who's in charge of the property, and what are the protocols for contacting the owner of the property? And then the development by the owner, with review by the town of a property owner response plan about what are the protocols if and when there are complaints that are code related and otherwise related to the property. So that's a very important but doable first task that would have a series of recommendations for action by spring town meeting. A second primary focus of the group will be to look at our current four unrelated persons family definition in our zoning bylaw and develop either a recommendation to retain it as is or develop proposed amendments to try to improve upon it. And having those recommendations on or before February 1st with the goal also of having time for those to be reviewed by the planning board and ultimately town meeting in the spring. The working group itself, I'm envisioning a total of about 15 members. I expect to be very active myself in the group. I have asked Dave Zomack, our Director of Conservation and Development, to chair the group. Dave will be my point person on this working group effort and will be speaking for me in the work of this group. I've asked invited a residential homeowner Phil Jackson to join us, Ms. O'Keefe, chair of the select board, will participate in this group. I have a commitment from Sandra Anderson to be the planning board ongoing planning board liaison on the Safe and Healthy Neighborhoods effort. I have commitments for two, possibly three, senior university officials to serve. John Kennedy, Vice Chancellor for University Relations. Nancy Buffone,
excuse me,
involved with external relations at the university, is possibly a third representative and also a off-campus student tenant that we would like to serve. I'll also be having a rental property owner serving, a rental property manager, along with the staff that you've heard from tonight, building commissioner, health director, fire chief, police chief, as well as planning director for the town. So I want to stop there and happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you very much. I'll start with questions from select board. First of all, I'm just going to say that this represents a really major formalizing of the efforts so far and the path to move it forward. In some ways, and you know, I'm very connected to this myself as someone who lives right on the bitter edge of the university. In some ways, you kind of hear everything that the staff was saying, and you're saying, oh my gosh, we haven't been tracking this stuff before. We haven't been doing this before. Like, why does this feel so slow to respond? Another way of looking at it is that, in fact, for 50 years, I was just doing some research on this, for 50 years, the town has been evolving different ways and different responses to try and deal with, again, an evolving issue of the university. The situation changes all the time. Personnel changes all the time. We've had a dramatic change in personnel at the top levels of pretty much everyone that has spoken tonight, and Mr. Musanti himself. The last 2 years have really made such a huge focus and priority of this from the town perspective, as you can see from the efforts that the town manager has devoted to this, that I think that this is really showing the town's commitment to dealing with the facts on the ground as they are right now and getting us much better prepared for the future. So I commend the town manager for his prioritization of this and the very excellent explanations from all the folks who are here tonight. So thank you. Select Board, Ms. Brewer.
I just have the easiest question first, which is the last item that you were just going through.
Yep.
Is the item that you emailed us on Saturday and has been added, yes, to our online packet, but is not in fact in front of us tonight. Okay.
You don't have hard copy?
No. Oh.
Nope.
Oops.
That happens when people go on vacation, when we occasionally let them go away. But yes, that is the only other item that we're referring to. We have lots of paper, but we had that one too, and I'm sure it's in the online packet, so everyone will be able to review it there.
Other questions or comments from Select Board, for Mr. Musanti or for any of the staff who spoke? Mr. Eden?
Yeah, just a quick question. How often are we going to get a formal update, if you will, about what's gone on? Is that going to be a quarterly report or semi-annual, or is that figured out yet?
To be determined, but I think at least monthly, if not more frequently, particularly the closer we get to spring town meeting.
But there's some months that are more important than others, it's true. Yeah.
Right.
Other questions or comments from Select Board? Ms. Stein?
I guess this is for Chief Livingstone. Is this new behavior by students of throwing beer cans, to me that sounds new. Is this new in terms of the history of the problems that you have seen, this kind of assault by students on the police force?
It's new in that it happens more frequently at less large events. It used to be kind of common nationwide at, you know, sporting riots or just riots in general. It became kind of the norm. So I think the last real incident we had was the 03 riot. It's new that it's kind of happening. It just kind of indiscriminate noise complaints where there doesn't necessarily have to be a large number of people. So yeah, that's really concerning. It's concerning to the officers, and it's a, you know, it's an area that we talk about frequently with our CCC group, and when I meet with the dean of students, and those are the types of incidents when we catch people where we've requested some really immediate action from them in regards to punitive action, and they've been very responsive to it. It's difficult to catch people doing that because they're usually behind something or in a large group, so when it does happen, they've been very receptive to punitive action.
And I'll just note that as a trend, something that's had a big impact the last couple of years is social media. And so you're dealing with much larger gatherings that occur much more spontaneously and just keep popping up all over the place because of Facebook and Twitter. So this is, when we talk about kind of an evolving response to these issues, it's because everything's evolving.
Yeah, absolutely. More frequently, we were being called from the residents who have, you know, hosted a party of 50 friends, and it turns out to be 250 friends because people start texting people. So that's common. That's a common occurrence.
Other questions or comments from Select Board? Okay, Mr. Weber, would you like to comment? I know we had had some discussion about whether the Planning Board was going to comment or not. I don't mean to put you on the spot. I mean to give you an opportunity. You can refuse that.
Thank you, Ms. O'Keefe. Just quickly, I wanted to thank the Select Board for taking up this topic tonight, and to Mr. Musanti and the rest of the town staff for continuing to pursue it. The Planning Board has been a sort of a center for public comment on a lot of these issues around zoning, especially. And it's a larger issue than just zoning, obviously. So we're thankful to have the, you know, it takes a village to solve this problem, and we look forward to helping in any way that we can.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll take other public comment at this time. Anyone? Mr. Cole. Please identify yourself.
John Cool, Precinct 2. I just a couple of thoughts and suggestions. Obviously, I strongly believe that when it's possible to catch the offenders, assault an officer, you're out of school, you're out of Amherst, you're out of here. And I hope that other people see that way. Secondly, I'd like to comment on the social media aspect of things. It certainly can grow a party. It grows it out of control. It grows it out of context. That is, we're getting people who don't have any relationship or who are so many times removed from, say, the party hosts or the originally intended party attendees, that there's a great deal of anonymity taking place here and no sense of individual responsibility. However, I also think that we need to study with some seriousness the ability to put social media to work for us. And by that, I mean things like if we have what I will roughly call a blitz of enforcement items going on, say on a first weekend of school, or a first particularly pleasant weather-wise weekend of school. And if we're putting together all of the tools that we've used throughout time and new ones as we develop them, such as cops and shops, patrol of parking lots, more response from the university, university administrators actually staying on duty at some very ungodly hours, they're learning some things and being a presence there. All of these things, I suspect, are lend themselves, if you will, however reluctantly, to being manipulated by social media in ways that could benefit us. That is, if somebody who's taking a case of beer out of a Southwest parking lot gets caught, then I expect cell phones all over town light up saying, "Ooh, they're patrolling the parking lots in Southwest." Or if somebody sends an overage friend into a liquor store to buy something and that gets interdicted, then I suspect, once again, as I say, cell phones will light up. So as we sit here and talk about social media and how it's compounding our problems, let's not forget the ways that we can perhaps put it to work for us.
Thank you very much. And for anyone who doesn't know, that was my father. There's always people who learn this new for the first time, and he was the only one raising his hand. That's why I called on him now. Anyone else like to make public comment at this point? Okay, terrific. Stay tuned, because you're going to be hearing a lot more about this. Mr. Hayden asked how often we'd report on this. There's no issue that I spend more time on than town gown stuff. I talk about it at select board meeting. I don't talk about it to quite the whole percentage of time that it takes up of mine, but this is a major focus of myself, of the select board, of the town manager. I think you'll be hearing more about it than you can stand to hear. But I think that this was really critical, and poor Mr. Musanti, I'm like a broken record about this, and I do this with the university too, is people need this information. All the information that folks got tonight about what has been going on as part of these efforts is new information to folks. The discipline information from the university and the forum that they're going to have tomorrow night, 6 o'clock, UMass Police Station, that's new information. In the absence of information, it's very easy for people to think that nothing is going on. They need information to the contrary. So I hope that this will be part of the town and the university and all of us getting more information out there, because I think that people need to know that, and this could not be being taken more seriously than it is. And as the chief said, Chief Livingstone said, so far our successes are mixed, but we're wholly committed to this. So thank you very much. Thank you all for the very good information, Mr. Musanti. Thank you. And thanks for all coming in tonight. Okay, 7:30. Believe it or not, we're actually a little bit ahead of schedule. How did we manage that? 7:28, let's see what we can do for 2 minutes here. Let's see, the Select Board Annual Report. Yes, I just keep putting that on there till I shame myself into getting it done. This is the report that I always during the week I say, you know what, that I can just finish up during the weekend. And then the weekend comes and I just cannot bring myself to finish the thing. So you'll have that soon. We did all these things. Oh, let's note the November 6th election warrant. And can't remember if we have a motion to this effect or not.
We do.
Okay, sure. Let's make the motion. We believe we don't need to vote an election warrant, but it can't hurt. Ms. Stein.
I move that the Select Board authorize the November 6, 2012 state election warrant as presented.
Second.
Further discussion? Mr. Hayden.
Some interesting stuff this year. And stuff we might recognize from town meeting.
Indeed. And so folks know, if you're interested in the warrant, that is also in the Select Board packet. It will tomorrow it will be posted many places and most likely including the town clerk's page on the website. So this is the ballot for obviously the presidential election. And it also has the text of the different ballot initiative questions on there. Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. That's unanimous. Select Board members, please make sure you don't leave without signing that, because we really do have to get that posted tomorrow. So but we will not sign it now. Okay, 729 is the same as 730, so we will get ready for our 730 item, which is, yes, it's that time again, voting and assigning select board positions on town meeting warrant articles. We don't have a draft agenda yet, and this is typically how this starts, that we actually start taking our positions on these articles before they have numbers, and that's how this always goes, and this is no exception. I hope that we will be able to get most, if not all, of our positions done in three select board meetings, but we shall see. Tonight we have several that are ready for us, and we will start with the Community Preservation Act articles, and we have both Mr. Zomek and Mr. Jessup here to talk with us about those.
Thank you very much. Good evening. I'll start, and then I'm going to turn most of this discussion over to Dave to, he can address some of the work in a little bit more detail than I can, in a lot more detail than I can. But these are projects that the planning department and conservation department have been working on diligently. And just to provide a little context for this, last year at town meeting we voted a $200,000 reserve, budgeted reserve. So we had around $275,000 or $276,000 possibly to be allocated or to be appropriated potentially at fall town meeting. Ordinarily, we make most of our CPA requests at spring town meeting, as I'm sure most of you know, we've done that in order, to the extent possible, to align with JCPC desires and you know, give some sense of continuity to that. However, not all projects line up neatly with the kind of timeline where you'd like to say, gee, we just have to hold that till spring, particularly open space preservation items and things that are being written for grants very often have timelines that are different from that, and to that's really what we're talking about tonight. We're talking about projects that are ready to move forward. We had some sense of that last spring. So what we're going to do is bring forward these three projects for town meeting this fall. So we the CPA committee has met. So we started our deliberations a little bit earlier than we usually do because we had actual requests in front of us. We didn't we concentrated on these three proposals. We heard about them at our first meeting. We asked for some additional information at our second meeting. We put Mr. Zomek through quite a diligent process of responding to our requests for more information and responding to all of the criteria that we use in the CPA committee to help us determine how we might fund these. Sonia Aldrich was kind enough to meet with the finance director, gave us some really great options for funding, and we moved all three of these forward unanimously at our last meeting. So there are three proposals, and I think what I'll do is I'll let Dave speak to each proposal, and when he's done with each proposal, I'll make a brief comment about what we moved and how we saw the funds being recommended to town meeting. So,
thank you very much. I'll be fairly brief. I think all of you received extensive information in your packets, including maps. Let me start with the conservation open space projects. I'll refer to them by the name of the owner. The first one is about a 20-acre piece of property off of Bay Road. Property owner's name Richie. This is a property, and I should preface all of this by saying these projects have been recommended by the Conservation Commission to the CPAC. These are projects that we have been working on for some time. As Mr. Jessup mentioned, we actually didn't have really any significant projects in the spring. So this is a little bit out of sequence, but projects happen, they come together, and we can't really dictate when they do. But both of these projects, the Ritchie and Brunel properties, have been on the Open Space and Recreation Plan priority list for many years. The Ritchie property in particular is a 20-acre piece of property up on the Holyoke Range. As you know, we have been working with the State Department of Conservation and Recreation, the Kestrel Land Trust, the Valley Land Fund, and a number of other groups to try to preserve the Mount Holyoke Range. This is yet one more piece of the puzzle, actually one of the larger pieces of the puzzle remaining on the Mount Holyoke Range. The landowners have been waiting for a couple of years to do this. We tried a number of different options. We tried the APR program. We tried working through the federal government. And for a number of reasons, in particular, that we couldn't amass other properties to bring with this to make it a larger effort, the property has kind of been on hold. So I'm happy to say we've got a solid appraisal. It is ready to move forward, and we've submitted what's called a land grant. We've done these many times before. We have an excellent track record. This property would provide agricultural land, upland forested land, which is habitat for rare and endangered species. It would also afford us additional access to the Mount Holyoke Range with a small parking area off of Bay Road. We've applied to the land grant program. This is a 70-30 match, 70% from the state. Our hope is to know the outcome of that grant before town meeting on November 19th. So that's the Ritchie property.
And the Community Preservation Act Committee voted unanimously 6-0 to recommend $151,500 to town meeting out of a budgeted reserve.
Thank you. Questions or comments on the Ritchie property? Mr. Hayden?
And if before the 19th of November the park grant doesn't get approved, or there's definitive action on it that is not approval?
Well, the excuse me, the warrant article is being written in such a way that the grant is a requirement to move forward. So it's contingent upon getting the grant. We've done these in a similar fashion many times before. Staying with that same theme, slightly smaller project in terms of dollars. We are working with the Brunel family off of Potwine Lane. Again, this is a piece of property about 16 acres off of Potwine Lane that the family is very interested in protecting and has been on our list for many, many years. Again, we're very directed, very proactive in the way we go after properties. We're not doing this simply what comes on the market. This is a property that contains habitat for rare and endangered species. It's along the Plum Brook, and it is part of a much larger protected block of land that Mr. Westover worked on for many, many years and added to. Town meeting authorized many acquisitions along the Plum Brook, and I'm furthering that work, working with the current Conservation Commission. We have a partner in this project, as we often try to do, is reach out to our partners. In this case, the Kestrel Land Trust is our partner. They submitted the grant with the Town of Amherst blessing to the state for what's called a partnership grant. This is a 50-50, a dollar-for-dollar match. Our goal is $163,000. The local dollars from CPA would be $81,500. So again, theme partnerships, continuing our efforts to preserve large blocks of protected land.
And the Community Preservation Act Committee voted 6-0 unanimously to recommend the expenditure of $81,500 for the purchase of the Brunel property to town meeting.
Thank you. Questions about the Brunel property? Okay.
Again, the warrant article will have a contingency that the grant is received. We will not proceed unless that grant is received, and we should know by November 19th. A slightly different proposal, and my office has been very busy earlier this fall preparing these. We, as a result of discussions with a variety of staff, from the Superintendent of Public Works to the town manager and our planning staff, we, as a staff, have been looking at the North Common. This is the area just outside the front of Town Hall, between the Spring Street lot and the Main Street lot. And South Pleasant Street, and as many people know, if you've walked that area and spent any time out there at the Merry Maple or other events, it is an area in town central to the downtown that is in great need of care and renovation. It suffers from overuse, compaction, root damage, root exposure, lack of any sort of area for water to move and water to leave the site. So we have a lot of erosion happening there in every storm. And so staff took a look at that, working together. We put together a park grant. This is the same program that we applied for funds for War Memorial Pool. It's a 70-30 match. and we put together what we think is a very competitive proposal to the park grant folks for approximately $500,000 to do what's called a design build grant. Year one of the grant, we would hire a consultant. It would be about $50,000. And we would hire a consultant to work with a variety of different stakeholders, including the Historical Commission, the LSSC Commission. The BID has expressed support and interest in this process, the Chamber of Commerce, town staff, and anyone who cares deeply about downtown and about the Common, both North Common and Main Common, to participate in a design. It'll be about a six-month design period. If we're successful in getting the grant and we're successful in getting town meeting support, we would begin the design process in January. It would need to be completed by June 30th. If the state grants us the money, we would then be in line for the construction money. The design would be completed, and then 1 year from June 30th, so June 14, we would need to have the construction done. So that is the North Common Park Grant.
And the Community Preservation Act Committee voted 6-0 to recommend the appropriation of $15,000 from the fund balance, and that we would borrow $143,672, that we would recommend that borrowing, just as we've done for other CPA-funded projects. So that would encumber future CPA funds at whatever annual amount. I think probably the most widely known project that was done that way was the athletic fields down on Potwine, we're coming up on year 7 or 8 of 10 or something like that. So we will have borrowing authorizations that drop off the table, and we'll take new ones on. It's a way to really stretch our CPA dollars. It does restrict us somewhat in the future from, you know, some CPA appropriations, because we have certain encumbered funds that we must approve. Generally, we would recommend they don't have to be approved from CPA funds, but we've always persuaded people that that's an appropriate place to take them from. So this is a similar kind of project. So that would bring our total recommendations to town meeting this fall of $248,000. The borrowing authorization doesn't count against our CPA appropriations, because that only counts in the year when we actually have to make the appropriation to pay for the borrowing. So the fall meeting would have the option to appropriate $248,000, and we have sufficient amounts in the fund balance to do that. Just so folks know, we just got a notice from the Department of Revenue this week that our CPA monies are coming in virtually identical to what they were last year. The match, which I'm not sure match is the proper term when it doesn't actually match, but the allocations are at 26%, I think, John, if I saw that, if I remember, 26.83 or 26.52 or something, very, very similar to what they were last year. So the good news is they haven't gone down. They aren't anywhere near the 100% that they were, and that probably will be the only match that we get, given that we're a 1.5% community. We probably won't be a second-tier level of funding, but it does give us a chance to plan for Springtown meeting our recommended allocations.
Thank you. Questions or comments about the North Common project? Mr. Hayden and then Mr.
Just Wallace. One thing. I appreciate all of the three presentations that you've given to us here to read. And I would one note on this North Common project. I particularly appreciate the little paragraph about how the public is going to get engaged with this design in between design and implementation. That's important.
Thanks for looking at me. That information all comes from Mr. Zomack.
Yeah.
Mr. Wald.
Just a quick question, mostly for Mr. Jessup. Could you explain how the fund would be apportioned between the various accounts within CPA?
Yes, the first two projects would be open space allocations, and I think the third one, the town common, I think at this point would go would be apportioned to historic renovations. Although, is there some portion that might be open space?
I think there's ongoing, my understanding is there's ongoing discussion about that. We want and we envision a role for both the Historical Commission and the LSSC Commission as our recreation commission to play a part in the design and the construction, if you will, the outcome. I met with the LSSC Commission last week. They voted to support the grant and the upcoming warrant article. I believe the Historical Commission is meeting tomorrow night, I think at 6 p.m. They've informally discussed the grant. I think our hope is that they would move in terms of a vote tomorrow night. In terms of apportionment, I think there's a general sense that a fair bit of this work is really about historic preservation of the common, and certainly there would be some open space, broadly defined open space recreation components. People do recreate there, they picnic. We hold a number of activities there, both informal and formal. So the LSSC Commission was on board with that. But I think there's a little dialogue that needs to happen perhaps between the two groups as to how the apportionment takes place.
That was my impression. Thank you.
Yep.
Other questions or comments about North Common? I can't remember what meeting I was at with Mr. Zomack recently when he was talking about the folks came from the state in relation to the grant for North Common, see how viable it was. And in fact, right before Mr. Zomack showed up, somebody tripped right over a tree root. The state person wasn't sure if that was a plant, you know, to try and persuade.
And I think all three of these proposals demonstrate one of the basic tenets that we've used with for CPA consideration is that we're using this to leverage. We like to think of CPA funds as, hey, we'll give, we'll recommend it, but where are you getting your other money from and how is this helpful to you? We don't usually want to be the sort of the sole source of funds. We usually go back to group and say, hey, use this to assure that you've got other sources of funding. And these are great examples of it, very successful, assuming that we get all these grants.
Great point. All right, Ms. Brewer, please speak into your mic.
It's a small thing, but for a town meeting, when you print all this wonderful information up for town meeting, probably worth reorienting so that these are matching the same way. South Pleasant's on one end and Boltwood's on the other end.
Sure.
To not confuse people.
All right, Ms. Stein, would you like to make the motions for the CPA articles?
Sure.
Okay, there are three. I move that the Select Board recommend to the November 19th, 2012 special town meeting article for CPA open space Brunel property.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. That's unanimous.
I move that the Select Board recommend November 19th, 2012 special town meeting article for CPA open space Ricci property.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. That's unanimous.
And I move that the Select Board recommend November 19th, 2012 special town meeting article for CPA historic preservation North Common.
Second.
Further discussion, Mr. Hayden.
I just want to note on that one that the balance between historic preservation and other stuff is still being considered. And we're calling it historic preservation in this motion, which is okay.
Right. Good point. Thank you. Further discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. That's unanimous. Excellent. Thank you very much. Thank you for coming in. Thank you for all the good information. And we still got a couple more warrant articles. Number one, we have to take a position on everything, so it's on here, even though it's an easy one. To hear reports of boards and committees, this is Article 1, standard, nothing dramatic here. Ms. Stein, would you like to make that motion?
I would, but before I do that, do you want to assign the three CPA ones to me since I go to the CPA meetings?
Would anyone like to fight Ms. Stein for doing the CPA article?
No.
Okay. We would be very happy for you to volunteer for this.
Okay, I volunteer.
Right.
I just thought I'd try to keep us on track for that. Okay, I move that. Would you like me to go ahead for the next article, which is the reports?
Reports of boards and committees, yeah, just move that one.
I move that the Select Board recommend November 19th, 2012 special town meeting article for reports of boards and committees.
Just so folks who are following along at home know what we're talking about. This is just a technicality article. We have to approve it in order to hear the reports of boards and committees that are not presented presented in written form. So that's what we do.
Second.
Further discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. That's unanimous. Okay, next up, transfer funds, unpaid bills, previous year. Mr. Yep. Pooler is here.
Okay. I know what this
is. Ms. Stein, would you like to speak to Article 1? I know that you like that one.
Sure, I like that one. I like the next one, too.
You can
can just do all of this.
No, well, those oh. two anyway. I all could right. do the next
Mr.
one.
There will be reports. Unpaid bills.
I am happy to announce that we have no unpaid bills. This is a standard article that we put on the list just in case. At this point in time, we have no unpaid bills, so I don't think that we're going to need to do anything at town meeting. We'll probably move to dismiss it at that point, but that's the status.
Easy.
That's easy.
Mr. Musanti.
Yeah, so the actually the recommended motion for tonight is to recommend dismissal, and then if in fact any such unpaid bills from a prior year for which we didn't encumber funds, we would revisit that at a select board meeting prior to the article really? Being considered at town meeting.
Okay.
I thought we just did this motion if there were to be, you know, saying.
We've done it that way too.
Yeah, okay. I thought we usually just go ahead and make this motion and then move to dismiss it when there are none, but we can do it any way you want.
Oh, we could say we move to recommend paying unpaid bills if there are any, or dismiss it if there aren't.
Yeah. Exactly.
How's that?
I like
Kay.
It.
Okay. I so move.
Second.
Further discussion, Mr. Hayden.
I'm curious, but I'm wondering if this is going to be part of the consent calendar.
Be even better.
It's certainly sure. one of the articles that should be a candidate for that.
Right, yes, mm-hmm. good point. Thank
and
you.
That's, of course, I'm looking at the response we got from the TMCC on our letter that right. mentions that.
Okay, it's been moved, seconded, further discussion, we discussed. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye, unanimous. Okay, next up, borrowing for road work, Mr. Pooler. And Mr. Mooring.
Yeah.
All kinds of people here to talk
about this one.
Ask Mr. Mooring to join me. I believe in your packet you have a list of specific roads, and I will ask Mr. Mooring to address which roads are on the list and why. I'll speak to the financial aspect of this. We went to the JCPC and we presented this item and they voted to recommend. This will continue a program of borrowing for roads that we started a couple of years ago where we borrowed $4.5 million and did some major reconstruction. We can use borrowed money to reconstruct roads. We can use Chapter 90 money to do minor repairs on roads. So when roads really get to a point where you just have to reconstruct them, it makes sense to use borrowed money. We then looked at this within the context of our overall borrowing needs and our capacity. This will fit in on a 10-year borrowing schedule. It will fit pretty closely within our list of projects that we know from last year were scheduled for FY14 if we go to 7% of the tax levy as the amount that we're spending on capital. And with that explanation, the JCPC recommended it. And then I will turn this over to Guilford Mooring to talk about which roads are on the list and why.
Well, we started this list with $3 million worth of work. And then the financial people said, no, you need to take a little less. So we went down to $1 million. So the list actually started out as being all the local minor roads in town that had zero ratings being on the list. And that's how we came up with the first $3 million list. We kind of grouped the roads together that made sense in working so that we didn't have a contractor come into town and we drag them all over town. We kind of had a contractor come in, work in an area, fix an area, and then go to the next area. So the list you have starts with Butterfield Terrace and ends with Thistle Lane to give us $1 million worth of work. And that kind of covers the East Hadley Road area, the Echo Hill North area, Echo Hill South. And then we have $700,000 we'll get in Chapter 90, and we're proposing to pick the High Point area to spend that $700,000 and do the roads in High Point area. So that's kind of how we came about it. Because it was based on $3 million to begin with, there probably is some room or flexibility if it's so desired to move around We would like to stay with the minor local roads, even though some people have expressed concern about that. We will probably never have to go back to do that work again in 20 years if we do these roads, we repair them, and then we can concentrate more on the major roads after that. So that's the thought process behind it. If you have a question.
You mentioned the issue about mobilizing and why you think things are all together in one area.
Okay. I kind of said a little bit earlier, but we did kind of lump the things together because a contractor has a lot of equipment and has to move it around a lot, so we wanted to kind of keep the, we kept these lumped together in neighborhoods so that we could get the maximum dollar for paving and not have to pay a lot for mobilization, which is moving your equipment around.
Questions or comments, Ms. Brewer?
Tell us about Mill Lane. Everything else I just expect to just get, you know, to look, to work properly, but what does it mean that Mill Lane is on the list?
Well, Mill Lane, only the paved sections are on the list. That's why there's two sections
sure
in there.
That's really clear.
Yep.
Only the paved sections. Nothing's changing with the other section, right?
No, but it'd be real easy to change it. There's so much gravel on that road from grading it that it would cost money to pave it. We'd have to bump something off the list, but on this list we only have the two ends of the road, the two paved ends.
I certainly don't want to complain about any list that has my road at the top of it, but how Mr. Wald's road and my road ended up at the very top of this list, could you speak to that? Are those really the two highest paving priorities in town? Or does it just show if you serve long enough, eventually your road will get paved?
Those are the top because we didn't have a neighborhood to stick them in. Butterfield Terrace
is orphans.
Doesn't have a neighborhood, and neither does Old Montague Road. Old Montague Road's off Highway 63, and so they just have no neighborhood.
I beg your pardon. Okay. Ms. Stein.
I've said this at JCPC, but I'll say it again. I wish there weren't five cul-de-sacs on there. I understand the proximity and all that, but I think if you look, you probably could come up with some roads that are more important than cul-de-sacs that only serve like three or four houses. So it could be minor, but it could be more important or more needed, let's say, than five cul-de-sacs. I understand the proximity issue.
Do you want to comment on that or no?
Like I said, we started doing $3 million and we kind of set up for $3 million. So yes, if we wanted to sit down, if we want to come up with a process for juggling some roads around, anything on your list that has a zero, and I don't know if you have a color list like I do.
Mm-hmm. I do.
So you have the red zeros. Anything in those red zeros would be fair game, and we could put together a program with those. And we also have $700,000 in Chapter 90 money. So, you know, we also would be able to get the High Point, as I said earlier. The whole High Point section neighborhood could be done with that as well.
You have a follow-up.
So if I sat down with a map and approximate square footage and suggested ones that didn't include anything near me, I want to make that clear, but that I felt would just have more use, I'd feel more comfortable. Is that a possibility?
I don't think we want to get into select board members making such specific recommendations like that, but I think that her point is a good one. How help people understand how these things get prioritized. So, for example, how all these things can be minor local roads, and I'll just use my road because I know it well, and Mr. Wald's because I don't know it well, but I know it a little bit.
But those are important.
So, but just to talk about how they're both so different. So, like, I look at my road and I say, okay, that's a major connector between North Pleasant Street and East Pleasant Street. And Mr. Wild's road is just sort of a road that only people who live on it would ever go down there. So how does something that's a cul-de-sac and something that leads from here to there end up kind of being equals on this list?
Well, they do and they don't. You have to pick some. We had to pick some point to divide roads up, and we actually divided our roads up into six different classifications of roads. So we have major arterials, minor arterials, major collectors, minor collectors, major locals, minor locals. That's just the methodology we chose. And then based on number of houses on the road, number of connections you can make from the road, and what we know for to be the traffic counts. We have traffic counts on some roads, but we don't have traffic counts on cul-de-sacs. So a cul-de-sac will be minor local, because we'll just use the standard formulas that are used in planning. So many houses, so many trips per day, that's the vehicle count. Lincoln Avenue comes up a little higher because we actually have traffic counts, unfortunately, that say, yes, it's a bigger road. So it'll move farther up the list. Your road, we really have no traffic counts on, so we just count houses. And your road becomes a minor local road because there's not that many houses, although, yes, it's a cut-through for a lot of people who actually are working at the university and university vehicles going back and forth from East Pleasant to North Pleasant, like you say. But there was no real traffic count, so you just used the households on it. That's how you got the local, minor local. Mr. Wald's road's definitely, it's out in the middle of nowhere. Most people don't even know where it is when I say something about it. But it's right off 63. Most people stay on 63 and just drive right by them and don't even wave. They just right back in the town. So that's kind of how we set the road classifications up. There could be a road that could flip up one or flip down one. Some may flip up two if we actually did traffic counts and so forth. But this is how we kind of set it up.
Okay. So, Ms. Stein, I think if you have further comment about how it all happens, what would be a productive way for her to offer further comment on that? You know, you don't want to get into select board members picking which roads are.
I think any feedback that any member has, it would best be funneled through me. I just want to add that I don't look at it as glass one-third full. I look at it as our list was well over 20 million 2 years ago with town meeting support. We spent $4.5 million just on major roads reconstruction. That allows this conversation tonight to even occur, because we're now starting to look at more of the traditional neighborhood streets that if they're done properly like this, we won't have to do paving work for most of them for the next 25 or 30 years. And we'll be able to attack that list in a serious way. So the long list, which is still very long, is one-third or so shorter in dollars than it was a couple of years ago. Through the good work of Guilford and his staff and Sandy and the support of JCPC, there's a way to cobble together another $1 million of property tax funded borrowing. But the long-term solution is not the property tax. This is a supplement to what we hope will be a much larger annual distribution from the state government for road repair and public transit. And that debate will be happening in earnest right after the first of the year in the legislature. And so that, coupled with some local monies where necessary, will allow us to get way down this list sooner rather than later.
Thank you. Mr. Wald, been patient.
Yeah, I mean, I understand Ms. Stein's possible objections to cul-de-sacs, and I think, after I thought about it after the JCPC meeting, I think I still come down in favor of what Mr. Mooring has proposed. He and Mr. Pooler did a very thorough presentation about road types, the way these things are calculated, the way they're funded and everything. And so the main argument, I think, is still the most bang for your buck, not moving equipment around, doing things in place. But I think there's another one we could add to that, or two, actually. And one is maybe not fairness, but a certain kind of generosity, because there are parts of town that perhaps never expect they're going to get these services. You know, they watch everything else being improved and not their neighborhood. So I think it's, in some way, it's a good statement of our commitment to the community as a whole to address things such as the cul-de-sac. The other thing, though, is about, we talk so much about neighborhood quality. You know, it's both demoralizing and a practical problem, I think, if you have five nicely paved streets and a cul-de-sac that is terrible. You know, if you're talking about property values, about communicating in the sense of caring for neighborhoods, quality of life, safe communication and transportation and so forth, I think there is an argument to be made for doing the whole neighborhood and not leaving out one street or two streets here. So I'll leave you with that.
Thank you. Other questions or comments, Mr. Hayden, and then Ms. Brewer.
Just very quickly, how close does this hue to the last report that we saw?
report before the 4 million?
About it, yes. There was, we had, I've got it back on my desk at home, and I won't look at it. I'm just going to depend on you to remind me how close this is to these having been near the top of that, near the second tier on that list.
They weren't. And that's because the big $4.5 million project bond we did, we concentrated on the major roads. And all the minor roads, local miners, all those are put down at the bottom and just forgotten about.
Okay.
So when you look at that list was created to address the major roadways. So the minor locals and the major locals aren't even anywhere close to being on that list.
Okay.
This one was meant to be go into the neighborhoods, do the minor locals, major locals, and try and clean up the neighborhoods. There is one other thing before you go on. When you look at this list, if you decide you want to give comments or suggestions, the red zeros are roads that are zeros now. This was a six-year plan, and the program lets us age the road in the program. The computer ages them. So the blue zeros weren't zeros this year. So the next year, they turn to zeros. The next year later, they turn to zeros. The next year later, they can turn to zeros. That's just the computer doing its process. So they're not really zeros now, although many people will argue with me about that probably. So when you look at it, the red zeros are the ones that are zeros now. Anything that's blue is an aged number because we ran the computer simulation and came up with the simulated OCIs on them, just so it's clear.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Brewer.
Speaking of clarity, is there a place where just someone who lives anywhere in town, say not on one of those top two roads, wants to look up and say, you know, I wonder where our street is in this whole? Is there a full list like this, or is there some kind of list like that that people could go look at to say where their street is?
No.
Okay. Because we do them for particular purposes when we know that we're.
We do. We haven't been able to put it online so people can look at it. The closest you can get to it is you can go to the GIS system mm-hmm. and click on the streets in the GIS system, and you can see the OCI, and that OCI is a little old. It's probably about 3 years old. But you can go and click on your road. It'll tell you about the segment of the road. It'll tell you when the town accepted or if it didn't accept it. And it'll tell you all that little information like the condition index and so forth. That's the only place, and that's about 3 years old, that number.
Okay, but it is a place.
It is one place.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else then about the borrowing? I'll note a point that I don't think was made. This is an unusual thing to do for fall town meeting, but one of the advantages of doing this now is that we get the money now and we can start paving in the spring as opposed to this waiting until next paving season, which wouldn't, or the next fiscal year that wouldn't begin until July 1st. So that gives a head start on some of this work. And it's taking advantage of historically low borrowing rates right now.
That, and we think we'll get the most favorable low bids by timing the bid over the winter. Yeah.
So I think that's really great planning. So I hope we can keep doing that kind of thing. Okay, anything else on this? Ms. Stein, would you like to make the motion?
Sure. I move that the Select Board recommend November 19th, 2012 special town meeting article borrowing in for road work.
And even though you miss the street I care about, I second.
Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. That's unanimous. Okay, next up, solar purchase other towns. So Warren article, this is something Select Board has talked about a couple times as we've dealt with the whole power purchase agreement for the landfill solar agreement a couple months ago at this point. And Mr. Pooler can tell us more about it.
Thank you. This summer when the town signed the power purchase agreement with Smart Energy, we signed an agreement with them for a project that could be up to 4.75 megawatts of power. At the time, we mentioned the possibility of having alternate sites, the idea being that at the landfill, we could build an array that is as big as 4.75 megawatts, but for various reasons, both for dealing with the neighbors, for trying to configure the site to bring it back from the property lines, to deal with some of the environmental concerns, just configure it optimally, we might want to have a smaller site. But we still need and would like to buy 4.75 4.75 megawatts of solar power. So we've been talking with our same development partners, Smart Energy and Blue Wave, about finding other sites, and they have been in the process of conducting investigations, looking at sites in other communities that are within the Wameco district to buy power. We have a draft agreement with them that the power we would buy, if it was not coming from Amherst, would still be at the same price as the power we're buying from the landfill. So from a financial point of view, it's the same deal. They are in the midst of doing their due diligence and investigating sites and going through investigations with securing options for development with landowners, talking with local officials and other communities about doing the development. What this article does is gives the town manager the authority to sign a deal for us to buy power from one of those other sites. Because this is a contract for more than 3 years, town council has advised that we need town meeting authority. So this would go to town meeting. It would give the town manager that authority. Once we have a deal with a site from another community that is, we think, a viable site and the right amount of power, then the town manager could go ahead and sign that deal. And that is the essence of what this article is about.
Thank you. Good explanation. So this is kind of part and parcel of the of what we already did at town meeting. That town meeting approved the idea of a long-term contract to buy 4.75 megawatts of solar electricity. We're going to try and get as much as we can from the landfill location, and we will try and get the remainder from this other location. So it still is the same contracting authority. Questions or comments about this? Mr. Hayden?
Yeah, I'd just like to recall the 4.75 megawatts multiplied by the number of sunshiny hours and the efficiency of the solar and all that, actually does not meet the town municipal load entirely. And that's important. It comes close. I remember it did come close, but that's important, right? Because we can't be contracting for more than we ourselves would use. And that's why
that's
that
right.
4.5 is important, is a real and an important number.
That's correct.
Yep.
Thank you. Other questions or comments about this one? Ms. Stein, would you like to make the motion?
Sure. I move that the Select Board recommend November 19, 2012 special town meeting article multi-year power purchase agreements.
Second.
Further discussion. All in favor, say aye.
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 That's
so much
unanimous.
Easier to move than it is to
okay, let's assign these before we get going here. Transfer of funds, unpaid bills. Ms. Stein, did you already take that one?
Yes.
That one? Yes. Okay.
I guess.
Borrowing for road work should be one of our JCPC people. Mr. Wald,
why doesn't
that one?
Jim do that since?
That's right.
I was just thinking, since you are on JCPC.
Contract authority for solar purchase. Anyone?
I can do that.
Mr. Hayden. Very good. All right. Next time, we'll have a bunch more articles to deal with. Thank you. Mrs. Brewer.
If you could ask to make sure that in our next packet we get the list, the lovely chart that shows who's doing
oh,
what.
Oh, assignment sheet.
Yeah. Yes, it's a yes, good yes. place that
Thank
we
you.
Make notes to ourselves, et cetera.
Yeah, we'll certainly have that when they order, when we get the order of articles.
All right.
But
time for our 7:50 item. We're almost 25 minutes late for that. I apologize. I misjudged how long the town meeting warrant articles would take. So this is a proposal to form a local historic district study committee in North Amherst. Again, we have a whole bunch of information in our packets about this, which is available online, and we have Mr. Michael Hanke here, chair of the historical commission, to tell us about this recommendation. Welcome.
It's great to be here, and one thing I did learn prior to this is that my road, Gray Street, is probably above Jim's road on that list. At least I can rest assured of that at this point. Not that anything's going to happen there, but you've been here before with a local historical district study committee, and you've appointed one before for the Emily Dickinson district. There are a number of districts that the commission would like to see studied, and residents from North Amherst came forward en masse to the historical commission and asked us to move this forward. So there's some momentum in North Amherst. I think Amherst in general, certain neighborhoods feel threatened. The historic fabric is threatened. The sense of a neighborhood is threatened. And I think residents are starting to see that the only way to put some controls on this is by using local historic districts. North Amherst is a National Register district. We're all very familiar with it. It was called the Dirty Hands District for a reason. There are mills and streams and other remains of the historical, the industrial past of Amherst in that location, as well as the town center of North Amherst, which has the church, the North Congregational Church, the library, the school. There are a number of other important houses in the district. So the Historical Commission supported this unanimously. We'd like to ask the select board to appoint, to consider and appoint a local historical district study committee. Now, in the paperwork, you'll note that the existing local historic district study committee could continue on with this. I'm not sure that they want to, but they could. There are certain restrictions. You have to start with a list of nominees, which are from specific groups. Most notably, the American Institute of Architects, obviously an architect. Two nominees from the Board of Realtors, and the local historical society. And then failing to get nominees from that group, there are a lot of other choices, local historical commission members, architectural historians, landscape architects, and on and on. Also, I think there is expertise in the neighborhood. Some of the people that brought this forward to us have done quite a bit of work. In fact, they are one of the residents of the area is publishing a book of historic photographs of North Amherst. So I think there is there's a potential to garner some participants from North Amherst. So basically, the select board would have to appoint these individuals, and then these individuals would form the committee, the study committee, and then they would take the time required to figure out the boundaries for the district, to canvass property owners in the district, and to figure out if there's enough support to move this forward to town meeting, essentially. And that's basically it.
Thank you very much. So this is the whole process Mr. Hanke described is prescribed by state law. So this is, as noted, exactly what we just went through with the Dickinson District. The select board established the study committee. It did its whole public process, did all the applications for the different seats on the committee, et cetera, did great amounts of study, and then was ready to bring it forward. So we would be looking at something roughly like that again. And does anybody else want to have questions or comments about this issue? Ms. Brewer?
I'm a little concerned about the characterization of a local historic district as being the only way to control certain things within a community. And that's just not the way I felt that we talked about the local historic district the last time. So obviously, as it plays out through its reality, I would not at this point vote against establishing one because of that comment, but I worry that that's considered the be-all, this is a be-all end-all of something, which it's not. It's only one tool. And I wonder if maybe Jim from as a historic commission person or Mr. Hanke wanted to elaborate on that a little bit more just for the viewing public as well as kind of reminding all of us. Because at this point where we are, of course, with our previous historic district is that we still have not been able to obtain the full range of membership of the actual ongoing committee as we had hoped. You know, we went through all the work, we set it up, the original committee, did all the work, it went through all the steps, and now we're still struggling to find the range of people to participate in the actual ongoing work of the committee. So starting another one feels a little resource intense to me at this point. I have no idea how we could possibly find staff time to support another committee at this time, but I don't want to deny the fact that, you know, this is what people can do. This is great. They can go through this process. So I guess I'd just like a little more context before we go ahead. And
okay. Mr. Wald had his hand raised.
I can speak to some of that, maybe in reverse order, starting with the last. We're actually, you know, we're getting to the point where we can go ahead and establish the local district commission for the Dickinson District. We have a number, as you know, a number of citizen application forms are in. We have the required ones from the obligatory groups, and so I think we're looking for some more at-large members. So this is an opportunity to say to the public also, if people are interested in applying, they should by all means do so, and sooner rather than later. But we had I had a long discussion with Mr. Malloy this morning, and we had been keeping in touch from the conclusion of the district creation at the end of town meeting. So his thought, and the Historical Commission's thought, as Mr. Hanke can explain, was that they wouldn't bring this forward till the Dickinson one is about ready to go. So he has, if he has the confidence that he can handle it, then I'm not worried about that. Ms. Brewer's point, again, Mr. Hanke may address this too, I imagine, but Ms. Brewer's point about use of local historic districts to control things is well taken. I think, well, you know, one of the arguments in the case of the Dickinson District was that the direction seemed to be coming from town and not from residents. It came from the town because it's mandated by the Amherst Preservation Plan, which town meeting funded, and by the master plan, and it's a standard preservation tool across the country, embodied in state and federal law. In this case, as Mr. Hanke has pointed out, the demand came from residents, so that, by the standards of the argument we had, should be a plus. But I think what Ms. Brewer is getting at is that we don't want to confuse certain things or to try to use the wrong tools for the wrong job. So as we've seen tonight and before, there's been a great deal of discussion in Amherst about neighborhood quality, about zoning, about rentals and things like that. And a local historic district is not going to solve that problem. And as Mr. Hanke has said at the meetings before, it's not going to, and it shouldn't be used for that way. But there are historic resources that are jeopardized by development, and it makes sense in a certain way, I think, that given that North Amherst is the focus of redevelopment, to put these kind of measures in place, especially when we didn't manage to pass the village center rezoning, which would have imposed other controls on design and form-based codes and so forth. More generally, though, I think anywhere that has already been designated as a National Register district, that is, it's an honorific, but it signifies that it's met a high national standard for historical significance, is worthy of consideration for local district status. Again, just for the public viewing this, we really have no tools to prevent right now outright demolition or wholesale inappropriate modification of historic structures. We have the demolition delay law, but once it expires, then that's the owner can do as he or she wishes. The local historic district would put some teeth behind the desire to preserve and to maintain the character. But again, not to be confused with zoning and with attempts to address social problems.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Ranke.
We've been very popular this year at the Historical Commission. Usually we're very lonely, and I feel like Humphrey Bogart when I had those letters of transit, you know? He says, I'm never as lonely as long as I have these letters of transit. Well, I think in general, to address Ms. Brewer's point, a local historic district cannot solve the problems, as Jim was saying, but it really targets areas that have considerable historic fabric that is important to the town. We've been getting pressure from neighborhood groups, the Sunset and Lincoln Avenue area. They're really concerned about the historic fabric of their neighborhood. I know there's a movement there amongst residents that's very strong about starting a study committee for that group. In that particular case, it's easy to point to the historic fabric in that neighborhood. It's going to be a little more difficult in North Amherst because the bigger area. So the study committee is going to have its work cut out for it. But it's really targeting areas with a lot of historic fabric. That's what it's meant for. The local historic district will never be an umbrella for the whole town. It really has to focus on specific areas. In the case of the Emily Dickinson district, I mean, it was a natural. We have a good understanding. We understand what you're saying, and our charge at the historical commission is to preserve as much of that historic fabric as we can. And at times, we feel very frustrated. I know residents have been frustrated recently with some of the events going on with demolitions. So I think this is going to become more and more important as time goes on, because some of our downtown neighborhoods, rich in historic fabric, are being threatened.
Okay. Thank you. Anyone from the public looking to comment on this issue? Ms. Holland, please come forward. And please identify yourself.
Hi, I'm Pat Holland, and I live on Montague Road, and along with my neighbors, I've been very supportive of holding this, forming this district, historic district, and I'd like to just share a book that I've just published. It's it won't be out officially till next month, but this is in the series of old pictures of both North Amherst and Cushman in this case. And so I hope that this would be helpful to people on the committee to pick out some of the houses that really should be preserved. The other thing I just wanted to say is that we ourselves don't have very strong feelings about the exact extent of this district. I mean, it could go all the way up to the northern boundary and all the way down to, say, UMass. That would be a long way. But I think one of the things I and several of us feel strongly about is that include places like Summer Street that really are, as in Cushman, wonderful examples of working class housing. And have been there for a long time and really give you the feel of what it used to be like there. And then in the part of Summer Street toward Montague Road, you see the houses, the rather bigger houses of the business owners for that area too. And then you get over to Montague Road and somewhat grander yet. So I think it's not just preserving elegant old houses, it's preserving ordinary people's houses, too, that we really want to emphasize. But how you do that and how much space you take, that's what I think the study committee would have to figure out.
Thank you. Congratulations on your book. Very exciting. We'll look forward to your signing party.
I'd just like to mention the difficulty in filling some of the slots on a local historic district, a commission, is the fact that practicing architects in town and realtors are barred from doing work in the district if they serve on the commission. So that is a problem that has to be solved. Fortunately, you can move beyond. If you cannot find those people, you can certainly find other town residents with expertise that could serve on the commission.
Interesting, thank you. All right, other public comment on this? All right, Ms. Stein, would you like to make the motion?
I'm going to pass to Alyssa left out of my packet was the relevant information.
Oh, certainly. First, Mr. Musanti is going to
I was going to suggest on the motion sheet that the word recommend nominees be changed to solicit nominees, because that's the next step in this statutory process is soliciting candidates, because there's not a list of names to be approved tonight.
Okay, then you have to remove the words as attached.
The other piece of it. Oh, okay, yeah, right. Maybe I should try and make the motion and then fix
sure,
it.
Then we'll amend
okay.
It.
So I move that we solicit nominees for appointment to a local historic district study committee for the area in North Amherst surrounding the existing National Historic Register District as attached, and that's the part that's attached. It's the map that we're referring to. The charge, which, because we have such a well-organized office now, from the previous Local Historic District Study Committee is also in our packet, therefore also online, and we could just fix it up a little to show that the charge does not expire in the past, but in the future, and that it would include special municipal employee status, and that it's for that North Amherst area as defined.
All right, hold on, you're getting ahead of us here. So we've got the motion.
Well, but we can't
appoint. So you're saying you
want
to add the charge to the motion?
I mean, we can solicit appointees to something that doesn't exist.
Okay, so I'm sorry. So you were still making the motion?
Yeah.
Okay.
What I'm saying is it's really more than a... The motion was perhaps miswritten in terms of getting a little ahead of itself, because we obviously can't recommend nominees if we haven't yet solicited them.
Right.
Also, we can't really solicit them very effectively if we don't have any idea what they're going to do. And so, arguably, the committee charge is just reflecting the longer documentation that we have from the state.
Okay.
So however you might like to break that up that makes sense in a way to you, but that we could solicit nominees and also the charge, you know, the charge that's in the packet.
I think that the first thing we're doing is we're voting to establish a local historic district study committee.
Arguably that is true.
Approving the charge, soliciting membership as described.
I think voting to establish is really the key first step. I agree.
Mr. Walt?
Just going to say, you know, I think since I was here to ask you to create the first one those many years ago, I think the reference to Mass General Law 40C is adequate as far as the charge goes, because it is, as Ms. O'Keefe said, it is all part of state law. So that, I think, is covered at least in this old appointment charge, old charge.
So what we could say is to establish under MGL Chapter 40C a local historic district study committee for the area in North Amherst surrounding the existing National Historic Register District, as shown on the attached map.
And to solicit members there, or you want a separate motion?
We don't even have, you know, frankly, we don't even have to say
that's
any
true.
Of that.
That's true, it's implied,
yeah,
yes.
It's in the Mass General Law.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good.
Okay.
Second.
Further discussion.
Back to the beginning.
I just want to point out that there are two municipal buildings that are within this district, and I don't know how the rules would apply to them, but the current district's rules would make upgrading these things to handicapped buildings, which we're required to do if we do any modifications, more expensive than otherwise, so.
Mr. Walker?
Maybe not. I mean, the law does make allowances for things such as handicapped access, solar panels, things like that. It mostly has to do with reciting rather than different materials. But
It doesn't determine whether or not we establish the committee, right?
Right. No.
Okay. Very good. Further discussion. All in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. That was unanimous. Thank you very much. Thank you for coming in.
Thank you very much.
So to clarify then, it's my understanding that moving forward, the office upstairs in concert with the planning staff will go ahead and go through the same steps that we did before, which are so carefully outlined here, and we'll start to solicit those people, and then those will come back. That's the next time it'll come back to Select Board, is when those nominees are available.
Right. Yep. Okay, thank you very much for coming in. Moving on, it is getting later by the minute. All right, it's 8:31. We are late for our 8:05 item now. 8:05 item is something we announced at the last meeting that we would talk about this meeting. Proposal to set 7 p.m. as a start time for fall town meeting. This is something that the Select Board has discussed various times in the past. Town Meeting Coordinating Committee did solicit a survey among town meeting members. When they did that, they got like exactly 50%. Yes,
like
no,
exactly.
And like one person who said they didn't care or something like that. But even that was a small sample of town meeting members. It was about 96, I think, if I remember, or 91, if I remember correctly,
right.
But something like that. So here is why I'm thinking that this is a good time to do it. First of all, this fall town meeting starts much later than usual. Typically, we start the first Monday in November. This time, we start the third Monday in November because of the presidential election, followed by the Veterans Day observance. So we weren't able to start until Monday, plus there were Wednesday issues there with the availability of the auditorium. So we're starting on November 19th. We only meet one day that week because of Thanksgiving being Thursday. Nobody wants to meet the night before Thanksgiving. So then we will meet the following Monday and Wednesday, and then Mondays and Wednesdays thereafter as necessary. This is obviously a very busy time of year for folks between Thanksgiving and Christmas and Hanukkah and everything going on then. To get that much of people's time and attention is going to be difficult. And we want to finish as soon as possible because we actually have to, the FY13 parts of the warrant finish our FY13 budget and need to be given to DOR, Department of Revenue, so that they can finalize our, what's the word? That's not finalize, it's what our
approve
tax rate.
Approve our tax recap sheet, which is the document we submit to get an approved tax rate.
So this is part of the end of year dealings that the town has to do. And so that typically happens in early December. So anyway, the longer we push this, the more complicated everything gets. So additionally, while our warrant is currently about 20-ish, 21 articles, some of those might go away before we sign it, it's very dense. These are not, you know, 20 simple articles. These are 21 fairly dense articles. So I'm very concerned about the timing. I think that this is a good time to give this a try. It doesn't mean we'll do it forever. We'll see how people feel about it, how they react to it. It might be positive, it might be negative. If it's positive, it has the potential to shorten not just our fall town meetings, but our spring town meetings. Our spring town meetings, which go on for typically, you know, between 6 and 12 nights. It's been a while since it's been 12, but, you know, it's a much higher number of nights. To add that extra half an hour's worth of potential time onto each session actually has the potential to reduce the number of sessions that we have to go at all, which is a huge time saver for very many reasons. But it's also a very, it's a greener option. When you think of the 100-plus, you know, cars that make the round trip to town meeting for every session, it just seems like here's a way that we can make a difference here. Furthermore, I don't think that this is a really dramatic change to put on people. It's not like we were saying to push it the other way, to push it to 8 o'clock, which would have a big effect on people. The fact is, if we push it, if we move it up to 7 o'clock, we cannot start town meeting before a quorum's worth of members arrive. The majority of town meeting will indicate their feeling on the start time based on when they show up. So I don't think we're forcing anything on anybody. We're enabling them to take advantage of starting a half an hour early. So that's my pitch. Ms. Stein.
Okay. I was going to say tonight that I really am not in favor of this because we have finally reached the point where younger people are beginning to show up as town meeting members, and I believe that the earlier time would be hard on them. However, I think you raised some good issues for a trial. And if we then have town meeting vote again, I would be willing to go along with it for this next time for the reasons you stated. I think they are good reasons. I am concerned about the effect on younger people, and I think it will be extremely aggravating if we are there at 7 and then people don't get there till 7:45 anyway. That's not the way I'd like them to vote. I'd like them to make a real vote. The other thing I worry about is the impact on us having to be there at 6 for select board meetings. I mean, truthfully, I find it hard to get my ducks in a row so I can be there at 6:30. And 6 seems that much worse. But I'm game for trying it once if town meeting gets to vote after it's done, whether they want to continue at 7 or go back to 7:30, because that would give the younger folks a chance to weigh in, or the elders. I mean, they also may not want to get there that early. So that's my thinking.
Was there a hand over here before I go to Mr. Wald?
Yeah, I take Ms. Stein's concerns very seriously, because I think one of the things we need is a more diverse town meeting, diverse measured by age, among other things. But I think it's an experiment worth trying out. And I mean, it could actually work the other way, because one of the complaints we have from people about town meeting is it takes so darn long. Who has time for that? Especially younger people with families don't. And so if, as Ms. O'Keefe is suggesting, this works out and produces a slimmed down town meeting, that might make it more attractive to younger people, people with children and so forth. But we won't know unless we try.
Thank you. Ms. Burr.
And as it turns out, there is not one time that all young families put their children to bed. And so therefore there are people think that in fact the earlier time will work better for them, because then they'll just be gone. You know, and the rest of the bedtime preparations will happen after they've left, or et cetera. So it's actually not quite as cut and dried or obvious as it might seem as to whether or not it's easier or harder for people with particular age children to do that. Again, pointing to the perhaps fewer nights. The other thing is, we have not discussed the 6 o'clock start time at all. We've only talked about 7 o'clock start time for town meeting, so let's not conflate the two and let's talk about that separately.
I am extrapolating. However, we do usually meet an
yes.
hour before, so I didn't think it was an unreasonable extrapolation.
Keep meeting at 6:30 and just talk really fast.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, we don't always meet beforehand.
Exactly.
That's true.
I'm going to support this. I mean, there are lots of good considerations. Maybe the most important one, though, is that we see that there's a way to do it better. We don't know how to get to that better, which is to say fewer sessions. I would stop short of suggesting that we change the time to 7 o'clock Saturday morning and finish when we finish. Some other towns do that and also have trouble getting quorums. But I think this is a good thing to try. And at least the worst it could do is get people to comment, to step up and say, well, you know, I was not one of the 91 people who responded yay or the other 91 who responded nay, but here is why this is important or stupid as far as I'm concerned. I rather like the idea that, you know, that adds a half an hour, which is, you know, sort of a quarter of a session, something like that, every time, so.
Okay. All right, so shall we vote to public comment first? Anybody want to comment on starting at 7 o'clock? Okay. So let's vote to start
sure.
at 7 o'clock.
I move that the select board agree to begin the special town meeting scheduled November 19th, 2012 at 7 p.m.
Second.
Further discussion. Mr. Hayden.
Just want to appreciate the TMCC for getting that survey out and maybe suggesting that they do another one during town meeting to see how it's working.
Yep. Thank you. Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. That's unanimous. Okay, 7 o'clock fall town meeting. Very exciting. 8:15 item, FY14 budget policy guidelines discussion. All right, in your packets you have a document. Let me find my document. That is a plan for how to proceed with our budget guidelines discussion and the guidelines from the current year that we are working from. Find my guidelines. Here we go. Okay, so my proposal is that we proceed similarly to how we have done this in recent years. We do this over a couple of different nights. At the top is bullet points suggesting the timeline. We're doing this slightly later than we usually do because we skipped our October 1st meeting because this basically would have been the only thing we had to talk about. With the whole town meeting starting later, all of our whole fall schedule is just slightly off. So my recommendation is that we tonight review the FY13 guidelines to consider whether we want to keep, revise, or delete any of them, and also offer any new guidelines ideas that we have at this point. At next week's meeting, we would then have a working draft of what would be this year's potential guidelines, and we would take public comment on that at that time. We would consider revising accordingly, also based on any new thoughts that we might have in the meantime. And we would have a similar discussion on November 5th, and we would either decide that we were prepared to approve them at that time or else that we would be waiting until November 19th. How does that schedule feel to folks? So this is what we've been doing in recent years, trying to have kind of a focused discussion about this each time so that we know what we're talking about. Okay, so if there are no objections to the schedule. So as I said, this is kind of a two-part discussion. So we'll start with the first part, which is simply reviewing the guidelines that we currently have for this year. Much like the town manager's goals, this is an iterative conversation and process that we've been going through for a couple of years now, and we spend increasingly less time, though that's not true. We look at these differently every year. We have been using sort of roughly the same budget policy guidelines, but tweaked as appropriate to the circumstances of each year. And we've been putting a lot of time into these, so I think the wording is pretty good in expressing kind of generally where we want to be. As with last year and the previous year, that first paragraph, the overall philosophy, I would suggest that we kind of leave that alone for now, because that is something that will sort of come organically from the discussions that we're going to have tonight and over the next couple of nights. So we don't need to talk about what our philosophy is. Our philosophy will sort of identify itself as we go forward. So it's really about all of the ones that come after that. So let's start with the expense reduction goal and see if anyone has any comments on that. So I'll read this quickly for folks at home, although this document is also online. Select Board continues to support appropriate regionalization and reorganization when such initiatives would reduce costs and realize efficiencies. We also continue to support reassigning services outside of the general fund where responsible and with due consideration of the implications of funding loss, mindful of sections blah, blah, blah of the town's financial policy guidelines, financial management policies and objectives. We support green initiatives for their short and long-term potential to reduce costs, and we appreciate the benefit of predictable power costs provided by a comprehensive solar project. We consider the negotiation of labor contracts that the town can afford and sustain to be of highest priority because salaries and benefits are such a significant portion of the budget. So this is all about expense reduction elements. Ms. Stein.
It also mentions funding loss. I'm not sure, frankly, when I look at the budget guidelines, where to bring up the CDBG loss. But it seems to me that funding loss might be the place. It might have come in the first paragraph as well, where we added last year the expenses from the War Memorial Pool. But I do think it's an issue we need to discuss in terms of the budget policy guidelines.
I think it's the biggest issue for the budget policy guidelines, so I'd like to leave that till the end. So okay. If we can kind of do the easier part first, the end of this discussion tonight, I mean, not the end of the whole process. So specifically about this paragraph on expense reduction, leaving aside the CDBG possibility at this point.
I like it. You did a good job.
The one thing that I was thinking is if there's a way to emphasize in here more progress on the regionalization issue, this is feeling a little bit stalled right now, particularly with regard to emergency dispatch. Mm-hmm. At the same time, we're talking about FY14. So do you think that there's going to be progress before that, such that the FY14 doesn't need to identify that, or maybe could still reference that generally?
I would leave it in because the progress could quite likely influence FY14 budget recommendations.
So adding a concept of looking for
specifically
for progress.
Yeah.
In that regard. Okay. So how do folks feel about that, kind of specifying that we're looking for kind of real concrete things to happen? And I can work up wording, draft wording on that to see what we think for next meeting. Ms. Brewer?
Yeah, just with obviously the comment that we haven't been specific in the past. And so the question is if we want to be specific about that and what other things might we want to be specific about.
Mm-hmm.
We don't talk about, we say a comprehensive solar project, which I guess
you have to speak a little bit louder.
I guess a comprehensive solar project is about as specific as we may need to get. But if I think calling out that it's emergency dispatch, I think is worth doing for people.
Okay. Other thoughts on expense reduction paragraph, Mr. Hayden?
We of course leave out a whole range of other things that we might consider for reducing expenses. Buying cheaper paper and painting things less often and the likes of that. I'm generally comfortable with that because that's a part of the evaluation that we're looking for that there. But I just wanted to note that.
Okay, so you're saying you don't think that that's covered?
Well, this is, picks up, it picks up the labor negotiations, the big one. It picks up regionalization, which is the most promising one right now. But, there are thousands of other little items. We have been very successful, even though it's not in here, reducing our expenses on energy, for instance, not because of a green initiative, but because of Stephanie's efforts. Doing things with controls, doing things with the air conditioning system at the police department. That's not here. That's okay. As long as we understand that it's being done successfully, And I don't know if that needs to be here as a result, but I just want to remind us of that.
Okay. Yeah, so you're saying efficiencies more in general. So
yeah.
Not just ones that are associated with reorganization or regionalization, but
right. I mean, that's
to always be looking for better, cheaper ways to deliver services.
Right.
And save money. Okay.
Right.
Yep. I think that's a good thing to add. Okay. Ms. Stein, do you have your hand?
I was just going to say sort of the same thing, except looking at different vendors for different kinds of products. Okay, power would be one, but there are others. I'm not promoting one or the other.
Okay.
And just so that we do things the least expensive way possible.
Okay. So if it seems appropriate to use examples, I will, without getting into what we always talk about, kind of the what and not the how.
Right.
So, but if that's illustrative, so I can
okay,
work on
I'll
those.
I'll give one example. I mean, it's just really specific, but we've done well to recommend buying drugs from Canada as a part of our policy. And but then I looked at, when I was going to buy a drug for my husband, I found that the Canadian price was more than it was with my insurance. So that's what I mean. Let's not assume that's because it's coming from Canada, it's cheaper. Let's continue to make price comparisons. And you know, that's just one teeny example. There may be other ways to purchase from larger, you know, more
economies
of
scale,
agreements, aggregates, that sort of thing. I'm not promoting one thing or the other.
Okay. Yep. I see what you're saying. Okay. Other thoughts about adding to and improving this paragraph? Okay. I will work up some language on that and get back to you on it next week. Economic development. So this is going to have specifics that are related to this year. As far as numbers, we recognize our most reliable revenue source is property tax, and growing our property tax base in net positive ways is critical. We strongly support pursuing responsible and appropriate expansion of our commercial sector, which currently stands at 9.7%. We strongly support expansion of the tax base in accordance with the community's goals as expressed in the master plan. We strongly support solar power generation and other green initiatives as opportunities for economic development. It's important to clearly articulate to the Select Board and the wider community the cost-benefit analysis of such pursuits, as well as their consistency with the master plan. Number will need to be updated, probably, on the 9.7%. Other thoughts about what that paragraph looks like? Ms. Reed?
A developing thought. I'm going to apologize that it's not quite cohered. The idea of net positive, there's so much crammed into that. I want to be mindful, but I don't have a suggestion yet how to put it down into print. But I want to be mindful that it's really easy to grow the value of our properties. There's a certain conversion process that's going on that has been a very positive influence in the value of properties. I know because mine got evaluated up as a result. But whether or not that's a net positive is still a curious.
It also doesn't grow our tax base. So the tax levy is what it is, and the tax base is what it is. So individual, I know you understand this, I'm taking this
yes.
opportunity to make sure that people aren't confused by what you said.
Right.
Individual evaluations don't make the pie bigger, they just redistribute
right.
the pie.
So just want to be a little careful with that net positive. And I don't know if we need to expand our conversation on that or add words here, or if we can just let it be understood that you know, net positive, economic net positive is not always financial or not in every way financial.
Right. So I think we had this conversation last year, but if you think it still isn't clear enough, then we can work on new words. We wanted to incorporate the idea that the bottom line economic improvement isn't the only factor, you know, so you could create a, you know, stick a prison, you know, in South Amherst, and that would grow our tax base, but it's not in a net positive way. So we were trying to kind of incorporate those elements into
it. Maybe we should leave it alone because I'm beginning to recall that conversation now. I hadn't before.
Okay. But so keep thinking about it and see how you feel about it, and we can revisit it, and we'll all do that. Okay. Anything else on that paragraph at the moment as we're thinking about it? Okay. We'll look at the other revenue paragraph. We continue to support the pursuit of new revenue through expanded arrangements with the university and colleges. We support regular evaluation of service fees for possible increase. We also continue to support advocating for state legislation that improves local taxation options, increases aid to Amherst, or mitigates onerous mandated costs. Additionally, we support advocating for increased state revenues, such as more progressive taxation, including higher income tax, in order to increase funds available for local aid to all communities, as per relevant sections of the town's management policies. Mr. Musanti.
Yeah, I think this might be the appropriate place to insert some reference to sustaining some or all of our CDBG funding, primarily serving low and moderate income people. And my broken record is infrastructure, financing, and regional transit funding, which is a very big legislative debate in the first 3 or 4 months of 2013 that we need to be, continue to be active participants in.
Say that again, what advocating for infrastructure and transit
advocating
needs.
For a long-term.
But I mean, what does that have to do with the sustaining funding for human service?
It's a separate type of new revenue for a different purpose.
Okay.
So that we're not coming here next fall with a property tax funded bond issue for roads as opposed to some other broad based state revenue that might be more appropriately structured as a more equitable way to pay for road maintenance.
Okay. So by you're saying that the conversation about CDBG is going to be bigger, and still I'm going to try and push it off until we're done with these paragraphs, but you're saying the relationship there is if you're not spending money in the various ways we're spending it right now because we have to spend it this way because the state isn't giving us enough money, then we would have more money to be able to put towards things like that,
yes,
towards the human service agencies. So through more aggressive...
Well, everything, right, including that.
Right, okay. Okay, so this is about being specific about infrastructure, really seeking, in particular, the infrastructure and transit aids, because this is where we're talking about advocating with state legislation, et cetera, which we've been pretty effective with in the past, the things we've been advocating for. And this is clearly where MMA and the state government is paying attention to right now, so this is a place there we should definitely put our efforts. Okay, Ms. Stein.
Okay. I wondered, this is specific, but it crosses my mind under this paragraph, okay? I wonder if it's time to reexamine the rates the university and the colleges pay for ambulance service. I'm thinking about the fact that it's been a while and I don't know if they've gone up. I'm just thinking that they are quite a drain on the town to the point that we have to call neighboring ambulances some weekends. And I don't know if that's a possible grounds for renegotiation. Just a thought.
Mr. Musetti.
We have a one-year extension in process for our strategic partnership agreement with the university, and a large part of that agreement is a payment to the town for the based on a formula for the calculated university share of providing EMS services. So that escalates with an annual cap on it based upon call volume and other factors. So that agreement will be up for renegotiation and extension over the first half of calendar 13.
Thank you.
So that was originally a three-year contract. Was it 3 years? I guess couldn't be more than 3 years.
It was
years.
Yes.
Because I think it was 2007.
No, it was a five-year agreement.
It was a five-year agreement.
Five-year. So is that what you're allowed to do, more than 5 years? Or I was thinking it was 3 years.
It is three, but
Oh, because it's not a contract, it's an
right.
agreement.
Right.
Whatever,
right.
Okay.
it's not a contract,
on that
that's right.
At all.
It's an agreement.
But anyway, so it was a 5-year one that that expired. So that was under all the original terms from when Select Board 5 years ago talked about
right.
Pushing this idea of the
right.
of the reimbursements for the emergency services. Due to the change in leadership at the university, it didn't make any sense to renegotiate
sure.
that with the interim person.
Let's
think yeah.
about it.
Oh, yes, absolutely. And that's yeah. Mr. Musanti and I have talked about other things that you might be able to include in the strategic partnership agreement. You know, it's kind of limited to some specific stuff, public safety issues and water issues. And maybe if you think more broadly about what the campus represents in the community, you can add to that. So yes, that is a good priority. So maybe that can we can call that out as a critical part of that other new revenue paragraph. We'll note the importance of the strategic partnership. Ms. Brewer.
Yes, along those lines, very specifically calling that particular agreement out because it was rather groundbreaking when we did it, and I think every component of it needs to be revisited, whether we decide, well, we're not ready to revisit that particular aspect of it or not before we resign it. We need to look at whether or not we are actually capturing the cost based on the formula we used previously, not just rolling it forward. And, of course, particularly, we no longer have Marks Meadows School, which was a big discussion item and is kind of a going nowhere discussion in many respects in terms of having children in untaxable housing. But it's still something that needs to be brought back again. And like you say, the water situation might be different, et cetera. So to relook at all those particular aspects of the plan, I think should be called out and the people want to just to review all of it. The other thing I think we might mention, much as I hate to pick on our neighbors, is I don't think Hampshire College pays us anything. And that needs to be revisited because
yeah, but they give us a gym, so.
Yeah, well, aside from that, you know, and I know we pay him the big money, we go on a lot of calls for nothing there, which is good. I'm glad that nothing bad actually happens, but we end up going on a lot of calls there, period. So I would think that it would be something that we would need to at least address, you know, for the public, this is where we're at with this. This is how many calls we do. We can't figure out a way to do it, but that there's where it sits for right now, and we'll revisit it another time.
Thank you. All right. Anything else? Mr. Hayden?
I find myself in a mildly awkward state of mind or state of thinking that there might be a guideline we put in here that reflects what we've been doing. Either by way of encouragement to do it more or by way of recognition. Between the park grants and the other grants that we dealt with last year, there's almost $1 million extra in our budget. We don't mention that effort here as being something that we want to encourage. We heard about almost $500,000 worth of grants tonight, which are supporting very important programs, and that's new revenue that I certainly am glad to be able to consider.
That's a great point. I'm surprised we don't have that somewhere. People good with including?
Yeah.
Grant issues. Okay. Thank you. Anything else on other new revenue? Okay, capital. Select Board recognize the perils of inadequate investment in capital improvements and remain committed to trying to incrementally increase the percentage of the property tax levy allocated to capital over time to achieve a goal of 10% per section, blah, 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 of town's financial policies. Select Board continues to support funding capital investment by means other than the capital budget, including through the use of Community Preservation Act funds, Community Development Block Grant Funds, and other grant opportunities through shared purchasing and ownership with other towns or entities, and through bonding or borrowing for large long-term projects. As noted in the overall philosophy, putting additional revenue toward helping us catch up on the growing backlog of capital infrastructure needs is one of the ways we would support spending beyond, which is necessary to maintain service levels. We know from the FY14 projections meeting last Thursday with Mr. Pooler that the recommendation is going to be to allocate 7% of the levy to capital this year. So that's a big improvement. What was it this past year? 5%?
6.5.
No, 6.5.
Oh. I'm sorry.
Something like that.
6.5. So 7, so we're working our way up there. Some of that will include as we noted earlier, the bond, the yes. authorization for the new road work that we have talked about. Other points that we'd like to make about capital? Mr. Hayden.
First of all, I want to say that I support this. We worked hard on this, and we kind of really, we worked hard on it to get to that. I just want to air my observation that 10%, 6.5%, 5.2% really is meaningless with regard to the reality that we need to have 2% of the replacement value of our capital budgeted for every year. And that's kind of a minimum rule of thumb number. And I have no idea if 10% of our taxation is anywhere near that, higher or lower. So I'm going to stop now.
Is that what organizations with giant endowments do?
That's what organizations that want to keep their plant going do.
Okay. All right, noted. I don't know if there's any way to include that
nope.
in here. Okay, anything else you want to say about capital? Or we're kind of, it's pretty thorough, Ms. Brewer?
I think that might be where some of us were imagining the word park grant appeared, under other grant opportunities. But I think it is worth pointing out that it was yet an additional grant that we went after that now we're used to asking for, and maybe we'll have continued success with.
Reserves, I would suggest that the reserves, rather like the introductory paragraph, kind of we leave it till the end, till the second or third discussion as we sort of see how this develops. So are we in agreement with that, Mr. Hayden?
Generally, but there's one important element to it that I don't want to see change, and that is the idea that we don't use reserves to fund ongoing expenses. We can use it for startup money to help things going on, but the idea that if you can't identify a source to support an ongoing cost, don't take it out of reserves because that's not sustainable.
Noted. So I think we won't make any changes to this now, which is in support of what you're saying. But I think that we'll continue to talk about it to see where we end up, which is a good segue to the CDBG situation. So. We are slated to lose up to about $900,000 in funding that we currently put towards direct funding to human service agencies, to qualifying capital expenses and qualifying administrative expenses. The human service agency funding is about $200,000.
180.
Right. Of that, and then the capital and the administrative, which is to say staff, a certain amount of staff salary is attributed to this grant as appropriate and allowed, is potentially going to go away. And this gets into your town manager's report item, but you might as well talk about it now. So this is something that you learned about since our last meeting. It has been in the paper. You have explained it to us, but it hasn't been sort of explained in a public setting. So why don't you tell us what the situation is and give us an update on, I know you had conversations with our legislators last week, and what your predictions are for going forward.
In recent years, the town has been just above the minimum qualifications threshold to qualify as a CDBG mini entitlement, and that has allowed us access to $1.1 million per year in grant funding. The last couple of years, $900,000. As part of a statewide update that they do every couple of years of eligibility criteria using updated census data and other information, our relative score with a number of poverty-related indicators declined, and that was true for most of the communities who have been qualifying under this mini-entitlement status. What was unique about Amherst, however, was that we were the only one of the dozen or so communities that qualified to have their lower score result in going from just above the threshold to just below the qualifying threshold. So with the help of staff, I have submitted a detailed letter to the State Department of Housing and Community Development. We've asked them to thoroughly review and explain to us the calculations and criteria used to make sure that from a methodological standpoint that the approach that was taken is sound, and where there are issues, particularly in relation to like how some of the scores were rounded, because we fell below the threshold by a fraction of a point. How the score was calculated in some categories was through rounding, whether or not that in and of itself caused us to go just below the threshold. We're asking for reconsideration in that case, and failing that consideration for what's called transition funding for some significant portion of our current year allocation for the federal fiscal year that begins next October, which is what this is all about. The current year money is not affected, but this is for a year from now. I did meet with Senator Rosenberg, Representative Story, last week. We reviewed our appeal materials and status and detail. There is additional outreach underway to Department of Housing and Community Development. And if and when needed, we will have the legislators come in and help support an appeal process. Right now, it's focused at the state and local staff level, going through the methodological issues and seeing where we end up with that. And then we're looking at legislative support, depending on what we find there. So I expect all this to play out over the next 30 to 60 days. Given where we are. One of the other rationales for transition funding is that the announcement of our change in status comes extremely late in the process. We've already actively begun our development of a plan for the Amherst proposals for next year. If we were to no longer be a mini entitlement community, we would be put into the competitive grant category that encourages regional approaches on certain things, and that would be great if we started that grant application process many months ago, but as a practical matter, given the timing, it makes it very difficult to be able to craft a competitive grant proposal, never mind be funded. That's where we are with that, and I'll be reporting to you as we go along.
So best case scenario is that they would reconsider and find in our favor.
Yes. So second best case is we're not a mini entitlement community, but we're awarded transition funding, and there's precedent, both state and local, for that. Back in 2005, 2006, the town of Amherst received transition funding the last time we were deemed no longer eligible. So there is precedent. We've had some preliminary discussions with the state about that concept, and that will be actively explored as well. And then the worst case is we go from 900,000 to zero, but we'll know that, we should know that really over the next 30 to 60 days, how that plays out, and well in advance of our, finishing our budget planning for the next fiscal year.
Would you say that the competitive process is one of our scenarios, or because we've learned so late, we're really not viable?
It is. We're technically eligible, but it would be extraordinarily difficult to submit a competitive proposal at this late date.
Okay, so we're basically looking at sort of three proposals,
right.
And I'm wondering if you might offer any sort of assessment of the likelihood of any of them.
I don't want to venture, because it really is speculation at this point. I'm hoping to be, I don't know. I don't know, but we're going to try like heck.
If we were to be in the transitional funding category, do you have any sense of how much that might be?
It has not been unusual in prior iterations of this here and elsewhere that we are transition funding is awarded for half or more of the amount. But that's a case-by-case kind of scenario.
And is that just for 1 year or multiple years?
My understanding is it has been done for more than 1 year, but I think it's most common for a one-year transition.
Other questions from select board members? Ms. Brewer.
As the liaison to the Block Grant Advisory Committee, fortunately, we're able to get an update on this from Mr. Zomack right before we went into the hearing, which was really helpful. One of the things I just would like us to all be clear on as we move forward, and of course we don't want to belabor it if it all just turns out great, because you know we have all the right conversations with all the right people and they overturn the decision and everything moves along. If that isn't the case, though, this is not only a huge problem for funding our shelter and a huge problem for the individual agencies that we have funded in the past that we took off of the town budget, that we would now, of course, have to face that issue again as to whether or not we want to reconsider folding something to our budget, again, something that has no revenue stream associated with it, so it would be new expenditures. There is also, as you have been bringing up, Ms. O'Keefe, for many years now, the more that we pushed, that we took full advantage of the administrative portion of the grant, the more of a difficult position that puts us in moving forward, because it's the same amount as the social services. It's not some tiny amount, it's a huge amount of money that we're spending, that's able to be spent on administration right now, which just because if the tasks went away, doesn't mean that there's a one-to-one dollar correspondence there. It's like, oh, well, we don't have the funding to administer something we don't have anymore. Well, actually, we're able to use it for a little bit. We've leveraged it for a little bit more than that. That is what you are supposed to do with it. And so we face challenges on multiple fronts. It's also especially difficult to look at, although it's very hard to think about all the various social service agencies and especially our shelter and how those would fit in. There are also the capital investments, many of which are quite boring, but are things that have needed to be done over the years. Unfortunately, we haven't been able to put any substantial amount of money into low-income housing as we'd hoped to, although we have put in some associated with Olympia Oaks, et cetera. And, you know, to face the idea that now the money's going to drop away again when every year we kept waiting for that right project to come along and now to not have the money. It's also funding, because we haven't had that project, we have been able to fund a lot of ADA-compliant areas. And so that's something that I thought about bringing up associated in the capital area, is that as we have renewed focus on our ADA transition plan, what with the changes in the personnel who are running that, and the DAAC is looking at that again associated with the coordination with the schools, et cetera, is what projects we might be needing to undertake associated with disability compliance that, again, we could have used this money for, we have been using this money for, even as we speak on Main Street, we're using this money for. And that, again, would not be there. So it's not like these projects are all so separate. They're very integrated into what we do on a daily basis. So it's just bad news all around, but I'm trying to be clear on just how widespread the bad news is.
So I think that it's clear that it's very important to the select board. It's clear it's very important to the community to be able to continue to fund these things as best we can. Now, this is obviously almost $1 million that we don't happen to have in our budget. We did the projections meeting with Mr. Pooler the other day, with the four towns meeting on Thursday. Thank you. Projections are for a balanced budget at 3% increases for the town, school, and libraries. 3% is for the town is a bit more than $500,000. So on the one hand, you could say, oh, well, there's that revenue. Well, as I said, the budget's balanced with that, and that includes the increase in capital and as the two biggies, the increase in capital and the increase in the retirement assessment. We're expecting the retirement assessment to Hampshire County to go up 7.5%. That's $260,000. So it's not like that money is there. what I feel like we're getting to is needing you to make a recommendation to us how to proceed, not tonight, because I think that this is still all evolving too much. The information is new. The status, as Mr. Musanti talked about, is in flux. You know, you said 60 to 90 days. Mm-hmm. We're going to need to be flexible with our guideline because it's the 60 and 90 days goes beyond when our guidelines would be done. But I think I'm speaking for the select board and saying we need a way to be able to address this. And so the first thing we have to do is to ask you for a recommendation that makes more sense than us saying, why don't you just cut the chairs budget, you know, so there aren't so many chairs in all the offices or something like that. That would be foolish. What do you think of that?
Yeah, I think that's entirely appropriate. And, you know, the timeline laid out in the Town Government Act is that I would offer specific budget recommendations on or before January 16th. So given this issue as a significant issue, you can expect me to be able to articulate budget recommendations that acknowledge this issue, while also taking this opportunity tonight to reinforce one of the themes that you heard from Sandy and I at the four boards meeting the other night on the projections, is we have to maintain our very strict fiscal discipline that has served us well through, you know, this, you know, god-awful recession and the very slow recovery. And while we're in a more stable place than we were, we still have a ways to go, and we just have to, you know, that's going to influence the recommendations that I make so that we don't have this slippery slope of getting into difficulty again like we faced 5 years ago.
When you think about how much flux we really are in right now with the presidential election coming up and what that's going to mean to the economy, with sequestration issue in Congress, and what federal issues are going to mean as far as the trickling down to being then state problems, then being local problems. So really, this is a very messy thing at the moment. So I think that as far as your recommendation goes, we'll see how this goes in the next couple of weeks, and to see how specific we might be able to get in here. But with our guidelines, but it's very possible that this is going to be our big philosophical statement in the beginning, but we're going to have to think about what we mean by that. It's all very nice to say we want, but, you know, then you have to make some hard decisions. Mr. Hayden?
Yeah, I just want to, one other thing that I heard at the four boards meeting was that 3%, that was level services. That wasn't, you know, that was keeping all the cops and the firefighters, the teachers that we have and the pothole fillers that we have now. Anything less is, well, less.
Right. Yeah. Ms. Brewer, I'll get to you. Mr. Steinberg also.
I don't, heaven forbid I should oversimplify, but one of the things we could consider doing to simplify is in the overall philosophy paragraph, about halfway down, where it says, while recognizing the necessity for War Memorial Pool and the bid, since we can cross those things out now, we could simply substitute in somehow magically dealing with the community development block grant loss, if appropriate. You know, and leave it just at that, I think, at this point, because we, you know, things will progress beyond once we turn this in. We may not have a final answer by the time we publish this, but that right there, just like we called out War Memorial and the bid right up front last year to draw attention to them, I think that we can do that effectively here, and we have plenty of other avenues of ensuring it's a priority elsewhere.
I think that would be a fine way to update the draft policies for going forward.
Right.
Then we've got a placeholder for it. I think it might be, we don't want to take the easy way out here and just, you know, give them the wish list of all the things. We've got to sort of take it to some next steps depending on what the recommendations are going to be as far as, you know, we're willing to sacrifice what for what, you know, and that's not a kind of a line item basis. That's, again, also it's sort of a philosophical basis, but, you know, that can become a reserve question. It can become a who knows what question. But we have to, But so, yeah, I
agree. Just in terms
of the
guidelines.
Get it in there to show that this is our priority and use that to be part of our draft goals going forward.
So you mean there is an easy way?
It's the magic money tree out back is we've really been watering that,
email,
nurturing
it. Would solve all our problems.
that guy in Kenya? Right. Mr. Steinberg, did you want to come forward and comment?
Thank you. Andrew Steinberg, Chair of the Finance Committee. I'll be really brief, but I did want to just touch base on the fact that Finance Committee continued to meet on Thursday night last week after the meeting of the other boards adjourned, and we had a significant discussion of the same issue. And I just thought it would be worth taking a moment to share with you the fact that we had that discussion and I think that our conclusions were pretty similar to what you've just expressed in your discussion. We did not vote guidelines yet. It was really an informational discussion that we had that evening. The reality that we all recognize is that the federal grant year that we're talking about, where we would be losing the funding, begins October 1 of 13 and runs through September 30 of 14. And we just came from a meeting where we were getting projections on a budget for a year that begins July 1 of 13 and goes through June 30 of 14, so that there's 9 months of overlap and only one quarter of the $900,000 then is available for the year that we are adopting a budget. And of course, this was all very new information to us at the time, and we just, that evening after, when we continued our meeting, heard the report that Mr. Musanti gave to all of you this evening. I think that in the end, our conclusion had to be that we are going to have to remind everybody when we issue the guidelines that the word preliminary, which we always use in the guidelines, probably is even more strongly stated than it has been in some of the recent years. But we do that with much hesitation because we know that the libraries and the schools are going forward and developing budgets and we'll be thinking about the terms of 3%, and we know that they're going to be really struggling to come up with responsible budgets and meet that guideline. So this is a very difficult discussion, but we don't know what we can do to reflect any change in our guideline at this point, because when we have to issue our guidelines in November, we will not have any of the additional information that Mr. Musanti has been talking about with us and with you. So that leaves us in a very uncertain status in the budget development process for the FY14 budget. But I think that the strength that we all have is that as a community, we have a budget coordinating group that allows all of us to talk with each other and to think very carefully and very cooperatively about how we will proceed, and that's a discussion that will be very helpful to have to inform us going forward. And the other thing that did come up a little bit in the discussion too was some of the questions about federal sequestration and some of the other, and the questions about what might happen in the year ahead should there be some kind of budget deal cut in Congress that will eliminate sequestration but result in substantial cuts. Some ways it's easier to predict on the sequestration because you know what cannot be eligible for sequestration. The other is really a larger unknown. But we also looked at what Mr. Pooler's numbers were, and we think that he was very cautious in his projections and his projection about state aid, where he had no increase in unrestricted local government aid. and a very small increase for education is at least some gives us some confidence that those numbers were suitably cautious under the circumstances and recognizing the uncertainty of where we are. So I think that we were a little bit less concerned about that side of it, but obviously are very concerned about the CDBG and made the same request that the town manager come to us with a recommendation as to what we might do on all of the realms that we have to work with as more information becomes available. So
thank you very much. Okay, so I will try and capture the things we talked about tonight. They will be in new working draft guidelines for next week. Those will be in the packet and online as of Friday afternoon. At next week's meeting, we will take them where they are, see if we want to change anything, and also hear public comment on them, where they are, any changes that the public would like to see, and see what we do with that. And then we'll, again, take it forward to the next meeting. So anything else that we want to include with this before we move on? Okay, good. Thank you very much. Next up, town manager's report. We already took out one of your big bullets, so we're leaping forward here. Okay.
Fortuitous. I wanted to talk briefly. I was able to attend the International City Management Association annual conference last week, and it was a really useful professional development opportunity for me. Was able to, I didn't meet personally, but I met many of the 2,500 or so city and town and county managers in attendance from all over the country, Canada, and more than a few from overseas. So that was fascinating, and that was probably the greatest benefit of attending a conference like that, was the opportunity to network with my colleagues. We had a number of areas that were touched upon in the various workshops, regional services, renewable energy and solar, a number of leadership related workshops, and probably the most useful workshop was a workshop on town gown issues, most of which we are familiar with, but we are not alone, which is not, you know, shouldn't stop the presses, but there are same or similar issues being confronted by college towns all over the country. I had the opportunity to meet a number of city and town managers from college communities, and have quite a bit of information from what the ICMA calls a college town consortium that I can be sharing with you and with the staff, and there's opportunities for further collaboration about best approaches. For example, you know, we talked earlier tonight about inspection-related programs and rental regulations. There's a lot of information and best practices out there in college towns, including comparably sized college towns across the country, about how they've addressed these issues. And I think that'll be helpful to our work group in the weeks ahead as we complete work on specific proposals for the spring town meeting. So that was ICMA. In terms of recent upcoming activity, we are in the home stretch for finalizing a draft special town meeting warrant for the November 19th town meeting. You will have a warrant that we believe is ready for your approval, consideration and approval in your packet at the end of this week for action at your October 22nd meeting. And then also in terms of coming attractions, the next step in our taxi regulations update is a couple of meetings with taxi company owners. We have one such meeting scheduled for later this week. Our intent is to see what suggestions they may have for refining the draft that's been circulated, and then put us in a position to finalize recommendations with you for action at your November, I think November 5th, regular meeting of the Select Board.
Questions or comments from Mr. Musanti? Ms. Brewer?
I'm sorry, if you could repeat that last phrase. You were saying action at our November 5th meeting, but we'll be getting something for our next meeting?
Yes, you'll get the current draft, an updated version after this week, and then the expectation is that you're in a position to vote any changes if you want at your November 5th meeting, which gives us close to two full months to then implement as part of the annual license renewal process.
And so when you give us the update next time, if that could have like a cover memo that had the process of public meetings and input, sure, and whatever from the taxi companies, so that we know what kind of feedback was received and what that process was, that would be great. Any other questions for Mr. Musanti? Ms. Brewer?
One of the items I mentioned last time, and believe it or not, I actually found my note to that effect, was associated with private security firms and as part of the safe and healthy neighborhoods aspect. So if we could just have an update on that in a future town manager report. Doesn't even have to be next week.
Okay.
It can be soonish, but just so that we understand what that role is when those folks get hired and how they interface.
Other questions or comments from Mr. Musanti? All right, moving right along. Member reports, BCG update. So I have this on here again just as a reminder to us. BCG meets, we got to get that meeting posted by 8:30 tomorrow morning.
Yeah.
If we're going to meet on Thursday. yes, that's one of the reasons I left it on the agenda. BCG meets hopefully Thursday morning. We are going to be talking about any feedback from home boards and committees on the recommendation we talked about before vis-a-vis the money going to the OPEB trust fund as the allocation for fall town meeting. That's a warrant article. We talked about it a bit last time. As you see, if you read the philosophy paragraph from last time, putting any additional revenue towards OPEB or shoring up reserves was exactly what we said last year. So to continue to support that is completely consistent with what we had said last year. But I want to be able to say kind of officially what Select Board's feedback is on that as opposed to just generally. So can we support the OPEB recommendation? Ms. Stein?
I think it's a good idea, but I do think we're a little bit uncertain now because of the CDBG problems generated, the staff, people, the shelter. Those are important issues. So I would like some money to go to the post-employment benefits, but I just don't know whether we're going to have to spend a little more this year to get us through the hump. We just don't know. There's a big question mark.
Okay. So just to be clear, this is for FY13. This is to balance the FY13 budget.
Okay. Right. I have no problem with that.
Okay. Ms. Brewer?
While still understanding that even though it's the FY13 money, if we put it in OPEB, then we can spend it on healthcare-related expenses, but that's money that's then not in reserves toward when us pulling out, potentially, in theory, pulling money out of FY14 reserves. Right. So, I mean, it still does have an impact. And so, I assume we'll talk about this at BCG. I am also your rep as BCG. You know that I am a little leery about the OPEB funding at this point. But knowing that we can use it toward current health care expenses if need be, thus meaning we could shift some things around, I'm less concerned about it, so I'm not planning to fight about it.
Yeah, so to Ms. Brewer's point, an issue she's raised before is concern about OPEB, and with the downside potentially being that the money was sort of stuck there, and now it's in this OPEB trust fund that you can't appropriate from, but the fact is you can always appropriate from that. Some people actually are funding their OPEB trust fund and working from that for their current, to pay their current health care benefits, is that correct?
Some communities are funding the pay-as-you-go
retiree health care related costs from the OPEB account. And so as part of their annual appropriation, there's an annual appropriation into OPEB plus some additional amount, but the annual appropriation is really a reallocation of what we're already doing for the pay-as-you-go portion, because that's built into our employee benefits budget in general government, and then and same thing on the school side and the library side.
So it is sort of globally part of the money that we have to pay for health care for employees, current and retired, no matter what happens with any potential state legislation or something in the future. It's always available to us for health care funding. And my understanding was that that eased your concerns
yes.
about it. We're not tying that money up in some strange way. Okay. All right, so we will be discussing this more at BCG. So I can make the point that there's concern that sort of the alternative is obviously to shore up reserves. Shoring up reserves for general unknown is never a bad idea. To shore it up for potential known is also not a bad idea. So the main thing that BCG is looking for is that we are sort of generally supporting either of those things as opposed to new spending in particular. So I think that it's clear that that's where we are on that. Okay. All right, liaison and representative reports. We're on a need-to-know basis here because it's quarter ten. Anyone?
Sure.
Ms. Stein.
I'll go fast. I did attend the Hampshire Council of Government Select Board Association dinner to honor John Oliver, Congressman John Oliver, and it was very nice. He did remind me afterwards that he will be my congressman right up till January, so that things still might get done in Washington. You heard all about the Community Preservation Act committee meeting, which I did attend, and I'm not going to say anything else about that. There are some points from the Board of Health, if I can find them. One is that the motion that will appear at town meeting about getting polystyrene out of the landfill, they came to the League of Women Voters who are supporting this, and the Recycling and Refuse Committee came before the Board of Health to present on this, and the board voted unanimously to support their article for town meeting. So I thought you'd want to know that. As it turns out, in terms of the businesses, if I understand the notes, only 40% of businesses are actually using these kinds of inflated foam styrene containing containers for their take homes. There is also going to be a public hearing on October 25th about the Town of Amherst public health regulation, drinking water supply protection. The main concern is to restrict activities in a small area near the Atkins Reservoir. So that was the Board of Health. The Kanagasaki Sister City Committee, one, they want to buy a flag when it is ready, and I know we're moving on that. They are going to be celebrating next year the 20th anniversary of the establishment of the city, sister city relationship with Kanagasaki, and also the 10-year celebration of the sister city's kind of libraries. And the one last thing is that they plan to send Halloween decorations and other artifacts to Kanagasaki so they could get some information about one of our holidays. So that's, I think, all that I was going to report on.
Thank you. Might as well go to Mr. Wald. A flag update. What can you tell us about the town flags?
Yeah.
Ms. Stein mentioned.
Ms. Stein has been working hard and consistently on this, and we're kind of in the waiting phase right now. So our artist, Barry Mosier, sent me, I guess around just before the last select board meeting, I think it was, the completed wood engravings that will be the emblems of the book and the sheaves of harvested produce, whatever species they may be, that will be on the flag. And so I just have to, he was out of the country for a couple of weeks and just had a new big project opening at a gallery last Friday. So he's just back in touch at that point, and just want to confirm with him the colors, and then he will put the whole thing back together, and I will consult with Ms. Stein and Ms. Roussel and make sure we have everything to meet from the standpoint of the flag company, and then go ahead and order.
Great. That's very exciting. Yeah. Thank you very much. Any other liaison reports you'd like to make?
Nothing that can't wait. And I think we talked historical was the main thing, I think, with the district here.
Okay.
And again, to remind people, if they're interested in applying for the Dickinson District, local district commission, that they should please do so.
Thank you. Ms. Brewer?
The Trivia Bee is a week from Thursday. We'll have to mention that again next week so everybody can come watch us be silly for a good cause. Two other meetings I'd like everyone to attend, because I know you have all kinds of time on your hands. November 1st, which is a Thursday, 7 o'clock, the Housing and Sheltering Committee is having presentation by our consultant on the housing production plan. So a draft has already been produced, people are giving feedback, and that will be the public presentation of that information, and then there'll be additional public presentation after that. But that is actually going to be in the Ann Whalen House on the 5th floor. So Thursday the 1st, watch for that. Anybody who's expressed curiosity about the housing production plan, that's the place to be. And the other item is on Saturday the 3rd, yes, 2 days later at 9 a.m., for towns meeting associated with the Regional School District Planning Board to make sure we are all on the same page as to what we are all talking about associated with regionalization. And that's at the middle school.
Thank you.
And Kulik and Rosenberg for sure are supposed to be there. Knock wood.
Mr. Hayden, anything?
All set.
I don't think I have anything relevant, so, yes.
I believe you volunteered to do this for us because you're just so nice, but the Hampshire Council of Governments thing on Thursday with the street easements, thing. So I'm an abutter to the Eastman roundabout, seriously? Like, really? I'm an abutter all the way down to the
any
roundabout?
University property, I got it too because I abut the university property, even though it's
okay,
Eastman.
Okay, that seems a little large, but at any rate, so we don't have to have a select board meeting of any kind associated with that, and you're just going to represent?
Mr. Hayden will be there also. We will have some excellent engineering expertise. So,
excellent.
Yep, we'll be
so
there.
A meeting I don't have to worry about. Yay. Thank you.
Okay, let's see, chair's report. I've given you a document, as I do periodically, that's just full of various ways that I have been representing us. If you have any problems with it, you should know about it and then let me know, and I'll try and change what I do going forward. So I tried to just kind of summarize any sorts of the types of remarks so that you know what I'm talking about, and there you go. Other things, the next meeting at 5 o'clock, preceding our select board meeting, is our annual coffee hour with UMass representatives, student leaders. I've been sending out about 60 invitations this week to the UMass folks, so that doesn't count the staff. I'm sure Mr. Musanti has taken care of town staff. I hope it'll be a good turnout. It should be another good meeting. This is a fourth annual, and we'll see how that goes. So that's 5 o'clock next Monday, the 22nd. And was there anything else that I was going to talk about? I don't think so. So let's do a couple of untimed items so we can get out of here. First one is town manager performance goals. All right, this is a process we've been going through since so many months. It is in our packet. So Ralph Karlstrom submitted a document for our consideration regarding the town manager performance goals, and that is, it's on the web packet. Did everybody get it in their hard copy packet?
Yeah.
Okay, so I apologize. The email came from him. So Coalition of Amherst Neighborhoods. So first, before we get into that, so we've been talking about this for many, many months now. At our last meeting, you urged me to just go ahead and just accept them as they were so that we could stop having these conversations. I wanted to tweak the wording a little bit of the final goal that we discussed that time, which was goal number 10. And also I made the adjustments to goal number 3 that we had talked about. We eliminated part B, so we had to incorporate, make 3A, make it not be A anymore, just be 3. Let me find my document.
I didn't look at it.
So I tried to summarize. So we were all in agreement with the spirit of the submitted goal about affordability. And I just wanted to take a stab at those words because we do try and be very careful with our words. So did anybody have any issues with the wording that was created there? So this was the affordability goal. So it's, and we wanted it to be sort of in the spirit of the green goal,
right,
that we had done. And so what I wrote was, the town manager shall help to support the creation of more housing that is safe, decent, and affordable for individuals and families at low income levels. I tried to take a lot of the exact verbiage that had been suggested to us. I wanted to take away what the original sentence said, was something like to make Amherst more affordable.
Right.
And while I think it's easy to mark ways that Amherst is greener, I think that more affordable, when you consider the fact that our tax rate is, you know, only going up, et cetera, like the affordability of Amherst in general is actually a bigger thing than we can address. But what we are looking to do is to continue to support the creation of low-income housing. So that was my takeaway. Ms. Stein?
Well, I have no problem with what you wrote, but if you're going to give us these to look at, I'm going to find other things.
So it's a question of how much you want to keep doing with this, and so we'll get into
it. I don't. So I guess I'll put these away, thoughts away till next year.
Okay, we can always do that. Okay, so then that brings us to the other memo that was submitted to us. So the Coalition of Amherst Neighbors, I think I'm messing up that acronym, I apologize.
Neighborhoods,
thank you. Sent us a detailed goal about safe and healthy neighborhoods. And so as Mr. Kallstrom noted in the public comment at the beginning, it was about having more specific criteria by which to evaluate the town manager next year. And so I personally liked the concept of the goal. My concern was that I don't actually want us to be doing the goals for like half the year. And so for this to come to us now, when really we should have approved these goals a couple of weeks ago already, I kind of didn't want to open up this whole a whole new area to be parsing as carefully as we've parsed everything else. When we added the goal last time about affordability, even though that was so late in the process, that was not something that had been touched on in the goals. So once that was brought up, it seemed like an important thing to want to include. The part about neighborhoods is actually part of goal number 2, goal 2A. Town manager shall continue to strengthen relationships with UMass and the colleges for concrete progress in areas that improve the community's quality of life by, and then there are several subpoints, but the first one is mitigating the impact of a significant student population on neighborhoods, on demand for public safety resources, on parking and traffic issues, and so forth. I recognize and appreciate that the submitted goal goes into a lot more detail than that. Excuse me, I'm banging stuff around. I think that it then throws out of balance all the other things that we asked the town manager to do by not going into that same amount of detail on all of those things, and also kind of makes very blurry again what we were talking about before about trying to specify the what rather than the how. I think that there are great points that are made and things that we should hold on to that and think about that as part of our thought process as we're doing the town manager's evaluation, that's kind of raising the kinds of questions that we want to be thinking about. And I think very many of them are very clearly addressed by the Safe and Healthy Neighborhoods Initiative that we had so much detail on tonight. My recommendation is that we not incorporate them into the goals at this point, because if we incorporate them into the goals, we're going to go through another few weeks of language parsing, and by then it's going to be, you know, December or January, and the year is half over and he doesn't have the working goals in front of him. So I think that it doesn't add enough to the goals and the outcome to incorporate these at this point in the process, considering our great awareness of them already and of the issues raised and the fact that it's already noted as an important area in the goals. Mr. Walt.
Yeah, and some of these things are already also explicitly stated in the master plan, and we've hired code enforcement officer and so forth. So maybe the best thing, I mean, I understand your reasons for not wanting to incorporate this wholesale, but maybe that's, it can serve at least as an impetus to remind us of the importance that the community attaches to goal number two and what stands behind it.
Absolutely. Ms. Stein, I think I saw her hand, and then Ms. Brewer.
You did. Okay, the point that you're raising is expressed as mitigating the impacts of the significant student population on neighborhoods, on demand for public safety resources, on parking and traffic issues and so forth. That's true, but it isn't exactly the same wording or the same problem, because the problem is really more of the taking over of neighborhoods by business entities and running those properties as essentially boarding houses. And so I almost wondered if we could just take, again, shorten, very, very short, not all the iterations, but just the first paragraph and take out the first wording and take out to include. I mean, he's working on it, but so it would read, the town manager shall develop specific recommendations for consideration by the select board to address neighborhood health, safety, and the quality of life issues. And I would be happy with that as an addition without all the subsets. But I think it's a different emphasis than saying UMass has to mitigate the effects of the students, because the problem is bigger than that.
So tell me one more time the part you would like to include.
I would just take everything out of the first two lines except the words to include. The town manager shall develop specific recommendations for consideration by the select board to address neighborhood health, safety, and quality of life issues, and just assume that we have the bigger picture. But it's more than just the university dealing with the students. So that's my thought.
I don't have a problem with that. I think that that's very clear what you are doing and what you'll continue to do. Shall develop specific recommendations for consideration by the select board to address neighborhood health, safety, and quality of life issues.
And just stop.
Okay, so you're saying in addition to or instead of what we have currently?
I was saying in addition to, because it's different than the university dealing with the students.
Okay.
It's a bigger picture.
So make that like point B or something? Or you know.
I think it's 11.
I think it's 11.
As much as I like the nice around 10, because 2 really is about the university relationship.
Right.
And this really isn't. It's related, but it's not. For all the reasons that Ms. Stein just stated. It isn't just because it's UMass students and UMass needs to do something about it.
Yep.
It's actually more purely about the landlord issue.
So I think that it does address the landlord part of it in a way that isn't currently included. I think it could be considered included by reference to the various mitigating impacts, but I agree that it does draw into the equation a different, it's not just with the university relationship, for sure.
If you think about all the people that reported tonight on the safe and healthy neighborhoods, they're not UMass people. It was the police chief, it was the fire chief, it was the health inspector, it was the building inspectors and so on. And so that's more inclusive under a point 11, which you don't have to spell out.
Right.
And I don't want to see this again anymore.
Ms. Brewer.
While we're wordsmithing it, do we need to have the words by the select board or for consideration by the select board in there? I think it's that it's specific recommendations to address.
That's fine.
I mean, he's talking to us.
And also the recommendations are to town meeting, they're to
right.
staff,
yeah.
they're
yeah,
to...
No,
exactly.
No, I agree.
It's not that we have to then say, go, John. You know,
We will,
but it's bigger than that.
All right. Well, while I hate to do anything late at night that we haven't given thorough thought to, I don't have a problem with this. Are you have any thoughts or concerns? That should be
no, because I've laid out an action plan that
exactly.
you... didn't object to and, in fact, enthusiastically endorsed
right.
with or without any of this in the formal town manager. You know, we could parse words about whether it's fully captured in goal number 2A or not. If you think it provides clarity by having it be a separate goal, I'm totally fine with that.
You kind of get credit for something. It's like recognizing something
yeah.
you're already doing. That is a big focus.
Yep.
Okay, so it's going to be that sentence without by the select board recommendations mm-hmm. for consideration to address.
It's just not even for consideration. All that's gone.
Just recommendations. Get rid of
yeah.
for
no,
consideration.
That's fine.
Recommendations to address.
No, that's fine. That's absolutely fine.
Okay, goal number 11. We good?
Becomes a prime number again.
Press publish.
All right, so let's make an official vote then to accept the 11, they're
yes.
growing every year, performance goals as presented and amended.
Okay. I move that the select board approve the FY13 town manager performance goals as amended. It's even in
second.
There. It knew I was going to say
further discussion,
that.
Mr. Hayden.
When we put back the walking on water.
Yeah, right.
That's
number 12.
Red Sox.
Right, Red Sox, that's 13. You're a busy guy. All right. All in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. That's unanimous. Yay, we're done with the goals. Okay, next up, we've got some minutes to approve.
I move
Nine.
That we approve the minutes. And I just have to find the dates because I couldn't find anything to correct.
My goodness, stop the presses.
Isn't that amazing? I move to approve the select board minutes of July 16, 2012 and October 1st, 2012 and cross out as amended unless somebody has something to say. I couldn't find anything.
Oh man,
second.
Now I'm going to have to read them again.
Try
Diana.
As she
second.
May.
She find
couldn't
something.
Find
it. Did it.
It's been moved to second and further discussion. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. That is unanimous. Yay. Minutes have been approved. Anything else? Nothing the chair did not
no.
consider. We've already discussed the trivia bee. We've discussed the coffee hour. We've discussed the meeting at UMass Police Station tomorrow night,
yep.
which is optional for all select board members and is posted as a select board meeting. And before Mr. Hayden makes his motion, is there anything else that we're going to be meeting next Monday, a mere 7 days from now, so is there anything else critical that we need to bring up before that time? Then, Mr. Hayden.
I'd point out that 10 o'clock is just like 8:45, and I move to adjourn.
Without objection, then this meeting adjourns at 10:01. Thank you very much. See you next week.